Birshus, distinguished Rosh Yeshiva and Rabbanim, esteemed members of our community, representing all Mostos HaTorah, Talmidei HaYeshiva, alumni who have traveled from far and wide to join us this evening, all of our Talmidim and friends tuning in to this stream live, and Achron Chaviv, the Chashiva, heartbroken members of the Mishpacha of our beloved Mashkiach, Rav Baruch David Aryeh Zatzal, Ben Rav Nosson Dov, Yibadu L'chaim Tovim, Rav David Sharfman. The Mishnah in Smacha states that Rabbi Akiva was not absolutely sure that his own son, Shimon, was a Ben Olam Haba, until he saw all the many people at his son's hesped and was certain to discount all reasons of their attendance for his own kavod. These people must have come, l'shem shemayim, for kavod hames and for kavod hatorah. In this way, Shimon was mezakis harabim, and that's chus to Rabbi Akiva, was a 100% indication of being a Ben Olam Haba. Seeing the hundreds and hundreds of people that attended and tuned in to Levaya in Queens on Erev Pesach, with Pesach cleaning and cooking coming to a screeching halt, just looking out into the audience to see the throngs of men and women who came here, who are gathering in Chafetz Chaim in Queens and all online all over the world tonight for Kavod HaTorah, is a 100% indication of the caliber of Ben Olam Haba Rabbi Sharfman is. A few announcements before we begin the program. The family would have desired for many others who were close to the Nifter to speak, but regretfully, time constraints would not allow. We hope that this will not cause any pagam in anyone's kavod, and we ask mechila in advance. Bezras Hashem, there will be many more opportunities to memorialize this great Adam Gadol. The family asks that the following announcement be made. Many Talmidim and alumni have called and written and visited. This has been a tremendous source of chizuk and nechama to them. Please continue to do so throughout the year, and for those who flew in tonight, to make your way over to the family to say hello. The Siyum Mishnayos for the actual day of Shloshim is scheduled for Yud Iyar, this coming Shabbos. All Mishnayos could and should be completed by then. We will begin the program tonight with two Kapitlach Tehillim. I would like to call up the Sharfman's two sons-in-law, Rabbi Yaakov Skolnick and Rabbi Yitzi Spector. Rabbi Yaakov will start with Kapitel Kuf Mem Beis and then Kapitel Kuf Lamet.
Kaili Eladaina Yazak, Kaili Eladaina Yaz Hanan. Eshbaich Lifanov Sikhi, Tsarasi Lifanov Agid. Is a tefal I ruchi viato yodato nisivosi boy razua halech tamnu fachli. Habet yaminurei ve'en limakir of admonois mimeni ein deresh linavshi. Zakti elecha adayno yamarti atomachsi chelki beretz hachayim. Hakshival rinasi kidaloi simoid hatzileini meroid fai kiamtsu mimeni. Hoitziyam imasker nafshi loidois etz shemecha biakhtiru tzadikim kisig moil aloi.
Shir ha-malos mimam ha-kim krasicho Adonai. Adonai, shema v'koli, tiyeno az nachar kashuvos, l'kol tachnunoi. Im avonos tishmaryo, Adonai mi yamod. Kim cho aslicho, l'man tivorei. Kivisi Adonai kivso nafshi, v'li dvoro hochoti. Nafshi l'Adonai mi shomrim laboker, shomrim laboker. Yachel Yisrael el Adonai, kim Adonai yachesed, v'arbeim ofnus. Who yiftas Israel mikol avonosov.
Thank you very much, everyone, for being here tonight. There's a long program, and if anyone needs a drink or anything to eat, there are refreshments outside. We'd like to call up the Nifter's dear father-in-law, Rav Moshe Kamen.
Rishus, Rishai HaYeshiva, Rabbanim, everyone who's here, the wonderful family, everyone who's connected online, even in Eretz Israel. There are many, many things, deep things, tzidkas. I mean, I'm very, very proud. My wife and I are both very, very proud to be able to say that this giant was our son-in-law. And there's so many things to say about him, but I'm going to leave that for the other people that are talking. I want to talk about something else. I'll just mention one thing. Right after Purim, I got a text from Rabbi Sharfman if I could please call him. So I called him, and he says he has a doctor's appointment if I could cover his shiur. So consequently, I did that for a week. I have to tell you that even though it's a first year Beis Medrash year, and maybe they had learned the sugya for a day or so, they already were in it on such a deep level that I couldn't believe that he was learning with them on this level, these Talmidim. In other words, the first year Beis Medrash guys, I shouldn't say the guys, Bachurim, were on such a high madrigal already that I had to work very hard, which that's not a trick. Of course I have to work hard to understand that it was a murderous taitzus. I don't know why he was even doing it with them, and they were on a sophisticated level. I couldn't believe that. So I shared that with you because I don't know if anyone else would pick up on that. I was thinking about talking about something else. Moshe Rabbeinu was sent. The Eberster picked him. He asked Moshe, please, I want you to go down to take the Jews out of Egypt. Moshe Rabbeinu tried, Shlach no biad tishloch. The Eberster said to him, according to Rabbeinu Yonah, if you don't go, no one else is going. You have to go. I don't know if he said you have to go, but he knew he had to go, so he went. He goes to Paro, and it gets worse. Okay, so what does Moshe Rabbeinu do? Moshe Rabbeinu comes back to the Eibishter and he says, Loma horeyoso lam hazeh, Loma shalachtoni. Why? Why did you do this terrible thing to these people? Why did you send me? So HaKadosh Baruch Hu's response is to Moshe Rabbeinu, you're going to see the Gulas Mitzrayim, you're not going to see Gulas Yisrael and Eretz Yisrael. What was the Eibishter telling Moshe Rabbeinu? So I have a mashal to explain it, and then I'll discuss a little bit more with the Nachlas Yaakov Bez Hashem. It's a little silly maybe, but I'm going to use it as an example because it helps us to understand. I was in the Rosh Shiva's Blatch years, that I was supposed to be there. I'm not anybody if not having learned by the Rosh Shiva. So this was before they invented the thing called sessions. So people who are in our yeshiva know exactly what that means. People who were never in our yeshiva don't know what I'm talking about. What it means is the Talmidim want to understand the shiurim. And there are two types of shiurim the Rosh Shiva gave. He gave a pilpul shir, which was a strong shir to the whole yeshiva, on a big sugya. And then there was a blat shir when he learned with the Talmidim. He's trying to teach us how to learn. Some of us did. I hope I did a little bit, learn how to learn in the blat shir. So nowadays, there are sessions on the shurim. Those days was before the yeshiva wanted to have sessions. So originally, the session started after the fellows who wanted to talk to Rosh Shiva about the pilpul shir spoke to him after davening. So eventually, he couldn't do that anymore, so he had the Rebbetzin tell us we can't do it anymore. So then the fellows didn't know what to do. What are we going to do? So they used to figure out when Rosh Shiva was coming in for the blat shir, and they would catch him on the way in. So one particular day, they caught the Rosh Shiva, and we set up the tables in the Beis Medrash for the blat shir, and we're sitting on the blat shir. I'm at blat shir level then. And they're talking to Rosh Shiva about the pilpul shir. Now, I don't know, some people know me. They know I'm a mechutzif. Some people don't know I'm a mechutzif. I was sitting next to the Rosh Shiva that zman, and my watch was on my left hand, and I was sitting on his to his left, and I showed the Rosh Shiva my watch. I guess that was chutzpah. I'm not guessing it was chutzpah. Okay, that's bad enough. About 10 or 15 minutes later, it's still going on. I did it again. But I'm very glad I did that. I hope in Shemayim it's okay. But I'm very glad I did that because the Rosh Shiva said something in my ear. He put his hand next to me and he said, Moshe, don't you think I know what I'm doing? Oh, wow. No, it was a charade. The Rosh Shiva was putting on a show that we're fighting over him. This way he didn't have to get into the sugya of sessions. I'll tell you sometime if you want to know what's wrong with sessions. But anyway, that's what he said to me. So I could understand. I didn't understand. It would look like a tug of war. Maybe the Rosh Shiva made believe it was a tug of war, but he really knew what he was doing, and he wanted to share that with me. Thank you, Rebbe, for sharing that with me. So then I backed off. So that's really what happened to Moshe Rabbeinu. he came to the Eibishter and said, what did you do this for? Why did you do this terrible thing? Why did you send me? I'm not sure the tone of voice to the Eibishter. The Eibishter said to Moshe Rabbeinu, don't you think I know what I'm doing? So that's a simple way of doing understanding this. The only thing is that we're talking about Moshe Rabbeinu. Everybody knows the story of Rabbi Kiva. He went to this town, no one let him in. He said, called over Rahman Latav, it's good. Goes out into the field, the wind blows out his candle. Can't learn by heart. I could learn by heart, but I'd rather learn with a sefer, right? Called over Rahman Latav. The animal eats, kills his donkey. They take care of his rooster, the other animal, and everything he says is called Dovid Rahman Latav. Rabbi Kiva is Moshe Rabbeinu. What are you, Moshe Rabbeinu? If Rabbi Kiva knows called Dovid Rahman Latav, what are you doing? What are you telling the Eibishter Lama Hariyot? What are you talking about? If you think about it back, if we back off, we're going to say must be the Eibishter had a good cheshbon to make it worse before he made it better. That's all. I guess the kids in seventh grade could tell us that one. So what's with Moshe Rabbeinu? How come you're saying Loma Hariosa Lom Hazel Loma Shalachtoni? Why? So I'm working trying to understand this. And I found the Nachlas Yaakov, who is a Talmud of the Talmud Muvik, in this Chumash it says of the Ramah and the Marshal. So he's talking about big man. And he's arguing with their aim a little bit. Want to get the back and forth. That's another discussion. We'll have a session on that maybe. So what did he say? He says, Moshe Rabbeinu did a very serious crime. Because he's asking the Eibishter, he'd be Mahara Achar Midos HaKadosh Baruch Hu. That's a serious crime. The serious thing, serious criticism. So the question I had is, why did Moshe do that? And Baruch Hashem, Baruch Shekivanti, the Nachlas Yaakov says, because of the tzar he had for the Klal Yisrael. Moshe Rabbeinu wasn't such tzar for the Klal Yisrael. He didn't think straight. He said the wrong thing. He thought wrong. You don't know what you're doing, Hashem. What? You can't say that. That's what he said. Why did he say it? Because of tzar, he couldn't bear it. He couldn't feel it. And this is the reason why so many of us, I'm not talking about the children, my children, my daughter, and the family. I'm talking about everybody I meet. Everybody I meet is in tzar. I was at a chasana last week, a happy occasion. Naftali Shmidman got married. I see faces, they're coming over to me, they're in tzar. Why are they in tzar? We loved him so much. He was so great. He loved each and every one of us to such an extent. Like I said at the Levaya, each one of us thought he was our best friend. And he cared about us. And he cared about Talmidim. A Talmud called me today from Eretz Israel. And he told me that how he took care of him when he was in Miami years ago, 7 years ago. How he took care of him and how he takes care of every Talmud. And I know. Because I was here one time and I was in the house and someone called him and he says he has a certain svarim to be able to answer the Sephardi question, Shilas. He wanted to be able to help everybody all the time, in the yeshiva, out of the yeshiva. I don't want to go to great length about it. But that's the reason why we all love him, so we're in such tremendous tzar. And because we're in tremendous tzar, we can't understand, like Moshe Rabbeinu couldn't understand. That there's a cheshbon and it makes sense and there's an answer. I made up a mushel and it might be a silly mushel, but maybe let us understand it. I told it to my son last week. Let's say the world was about to collapse, which it probably is all the time, but the Eibishter keeps it up for us. But let's say it was about to collapse and we found that the only way to keep it in existence is if we had a satellite up in Shemayim and the satellite is going to be operated by a computer, but the computer might go down, and therefore there has to be a person up in the satellite to keep it going all the time. So we take a young man who's he happens to be married because he's the only guy that knows how to do this, and he has a family, and we're going to send him up to Shemayim, up to the satellite to keep the world up. We're all going to be very sad for the family, but it's not going to be the same tsar that we have now, because we're unable to dehair what is going on in Shemayim and why the Eibishter needs him. I don't know why the Eibishter needs him, but the Eibishter took him to Shemayim to help all of us. And like the Rosh Yeshiva Zetzal used to say to the families, he used to say that your father is doing more for you in Shemayim than he ever could get done for you down here. And that's what Ramatl Gifter said. It's all about the Rosh Yeshiva's father, how the Rosh Yeshiva's father made the Rosh Yeshiva, made it so that the Rosh Yeshiva could be successful in the yeshiva. That's what the Gedolim are saying. And the giant, my holy son-in-law, I'm making myself credit, my wife and I, we get credit because he's our son-in-law. Zeichen Tzadik Levrocha. He's up there in Shemayim. Yehei Zichro Baruch.
I was waiting for the first speaker that was going to mention that point. I think this little jar should be encased symbolic to the mishpacha, a mother of a fourth grade girl. When we were davening, beseeching the Ribbono Shel'olam for a refuah shleima, these two fourth grade girls went around collecting tzedaka as a zchus for the chola, and they were heartbroken. They came to me yesterday with this jar. What will they do with this jar? So we decided we're going to give it to the mishpacha. They should decide which tzedaka to give it to. Perhaps keep it as a symbol of the deep impact that Rabbi Sharfman Zatzal had during his illness and afterwards. It's a big cover for us to have with us the Rosh Yeshiva of Yeshivas Chafetz Chaim, one of the founding Rosh Yeshivas here in Miami, and the one who hired Rabbi Sharfman to come down here as Mashkiach and teaching ninth grade is his first year. It's our cover to welcome Rav Akiva Grimblatt Shlita.
The Shus, Rosh Yeshiva, Rabbanim, Chashva audience, it's always very difficult when you need to speak about such a chashuv person, because people like that are so multifaceted, there's so much about them. And to sort of like try to get an overview doesn't do justice to anything. And so what I thought to do was to really speak about one aspect. There are so many other things, but you've got to do something. It's true that I was the one who hired Rabbi Sharfman. I knew him as a bacher, and actually he was part of the first group of Beis Medrash branch guys to come along with Rav Mordechai Palgan, was part of that group as well as others. And I kind of had my eye on him, and when the right time arose, we approached him. He came down for a visit. And we started having second thoughts. Came to this visit, and he came across as very, very businesslike. And, you know, everything has to be run properly. I remember we were talking about things like Shabbatons and extracurricular activities, and he made the comment, you know, yeshiva is not a camp. And we were a little bit scared off. You know, we want somebody who could be warm, could be connecting. Of course, yeshiva is not a camp, but it is a little bit. So we got a little nervous. So I remember I called Rav Shlomo Yonason Harris, and if memory serves, I could be a little bit confused about the facts, but I believe what he told me was he could see how he might come across that way, but I want you to know he once taught Bekiyas in a high school by us, and he had a closer kesher to the Talmidim than their Iyun Rebbe, than the main Rebbe. And, of course, everybody knows that our fears were ridiculous. But thinking back, I realize that Rabbi Sharfman Zatzal embodied what I would call a stira. There is a certain contradiction in the way a Rebbe must relate to Talmidim. And it's not so easy to pull it off properly. Rosh Hashiva Zatzal often used to quote the Sefarnu in Parshas Baaloscha. Pasuk says, Anochi Arisi Amazeh, Moshe Rabbeinu was at his wit's end, Klal Yisrael was complaining. He said, I didn't give birth to them. And the Sefarnu says, Hine Av Yochel Lahanig Es Banav. A father could lead his children, Afal Pishem Chiluke Deus, even though they disagree. Bezeki Kulam Choshem Osel Ohev. They all believe he loves them. Who's doing his best to do good for them. But they don't trust me, and therefore it's necessary to have Shivim Zakanim who are more closely related to them so that they could lead him properly. And Moshe went on to say that if there is some reason, according to the Sefarnu, if you feel that you can't do that because it's going to be a pagam, it's going to be an encroachment on my own dignity, my own honor, so I have a perfect solution for you. Hargeni Naharog, why didn't you just kill me? And I won't be in the way, and Klal Yisrael could have proper leadership. And Rosh Hashiva Zatzal pointed out that Moshe Rabbeinu surely understood that if he were to die, Klal Yisrael would be losing something. He's the one who gave them Torah, he was the one who was selected. So what would they get in replacement? Zion Zakanim, Ayin Zakanim, it's true, they're a little more closely related, but they're not the fathers either. Right? There's 70 of them, 600,000 Jews. So it's my second cousin twice removed? And didn't Moshe Rabbeinu love them? Didn't they see that? Wasn't he Moser Nefesh for them? Didn't he say, Ayin Mecheni Na Misifrecha Asher Kasafta? He was ready to give up everything? But somehow they'd have a little more confidence in the love of their leaders. It was worth it for Moshe Rabbeinu to be taken away. So how important it is for a Talmud to know that the Rebbe loves them. It has to be that feeling, that ahava. But the Sefarnu says something else in Parshas Emor. A Kohen is not allowed to be metame, except for his family. Why, says the Sefarnu? Amnam ha-koin hu baal ba'amav. He is a leader amongst his people. Lahavin v'laharos. To make people understand Torah and to teach them. Ki sifsei koin yishmeru das v'tor yivakshu mipiyu. His role is to be a teacher, to be a Rebbe. V'roi le'ish kazel linhog nisius. A person like that has to be princely, dignified. Ki hechi dilishtami milei, in order that people should listen to him. And Rosh Hashiva Zatzal pointed out that what better occasion is there to connect to a person when Nebuchadnezzar Litzlan, he's going through such a tzara, a close family member passed away, and you could be there with him and comfort him and give him chizuk. What kind of kesher does that develop? Doesn't the Talmud have to know that the Rebbe loves him? Same Sefarnu. No. There has to be nesius, dignity. It's a p'chisas ha-kavod for the Kohen to become Tameh. There's a balance. Somehow you have to carry out both at the same time. I think that was a remarkable accomplishment of the Heilige Nifter, Baruch David Aryeh ben Yibadu L'chaim Tovim, Nosendov. He had a certain dignity, aristocracy, nesius. At the same time, he was warm and connecting and loving. A Talmud didn't think of him as a buddy, but they thought of him as a father, as a friend, somebody who cared for them. You know, there's an interesting Rashi. In Parshas Matos, Klal Yisrael was given the commandment to take care of Midian, and they were told that afterwards Moshe Rabbeinu would pass away. So they didn't want to go. It says, "Vayi Mustra Mafayim." He had to force them to go to the battle. They didn't want to go because they didn't want Moshe to leave them. It says Rashi, "Laodia Shvachan Sharoi Yisrael." It's to teach you the praise of the leaders of Kal Yisrael. Kamehem Chavivim Al Yisrael. How beloved they are to the Jewish people. Ad Shelo Shamu Misaso. Before they knew he was going to die, Mahu Omer was a pasuk say, "O de Maat Uskaluni." Moshe was remonstrating with them, "A little bit more, they will stone me." Umisha Shama Shemisas Moshe Tzuliyah ben Nikmas Midian. When they heard that the death of Moshe was dependent on the vengeance against Midian, LaRotzu Aleches, they didn't want to go. Ad Shemasu Al Karcha. Why does Rashi mention Od Ma'adus Kaluni? You're talking about Shvach and how much Klal Yisrael loves them. What's the point of saying Od Ma'adus Kaluni? They were ready to stone him. I think the pshat is obvious. It's not enough. That's not such a shvach, the fact that they love him. Maybe they love him because he always does what they want him to do. A leader who gives you everything you want, maybe you'll love him. Is that really such a great leader? Isn't a leader supposed to lead you to places where maybe you wouldn't go without him? Isn't he supposed to inspire you, encourage you, push you? And if he's doing that, don't you get upset at him? So what did Moshe Rabbeinu do? He didn't do whatever the Klal Yisrael wanted him to do. He did what was right. Od Ma'adus Kaluni, he challenged them. And at times they were angry at him. But yet, they loved him. Kama Chavivin Alayim, they didn't want to go. Because they understood that everything he did was with Ava, was for their best interests. Rabbi Sharfman, yes, he maintained his dignity, his aristocracy, his nesius. But every Talmud and everybody he came into contact with knew that he didn't care an iota for himself, he cared about you. And perhaps sometimes you were annoyed with him. Sometimes he made you do things you maybe didn't want to do or tried to. But we understood how much he loved all of us. And that's why his loss is so difficult. And echoing what Rabbi Kamen said, I'm not here to offer explanations because we are puny human beings. But I think if we appreciate a lot of what he accomplished, we understand what he did with his life. You can accomplish sometimes in a short time what other people take three lifetimes to do. I mentioned to the family, Shmuel Hanavi lived 52 years, but Shmuel was equal to Moshe and Aaron. And we could take some comfort from that and some inspiration from that until the day when HaKadosh Baruch Hu sees fit to be Mekayim Asher Kasav Ubilu Hamavas Lanetzach. Yehi Zichro Baruch.
Going to be calling up now the sons. We're going to be speaking. Before I call the eldest up, intertwined with this great tragedy was the great simcha of Yaakov Hillel's chasana with the Shmidman Mishpacha who are here. And throughout this entire sequence of events, it was Yogan and Simcha intertwined. message perhaps for us all. And what Yaakov Hillel and the Mishpacha dealt with throughout all this, we were literally following this with bated breath, making it to the chasana, and then how ill he looked or felt at the chasana. So with Kovod Gadol, we'd like first to call on Yaakov Hillel Sharfman to address us.
I was speaking to a Rosh Yeshiva in Eretz Yisrael who did not really have much shaychus to my father, but he spent some time around my father. He had a few conversations with him. He observed him. He was very impressed with my father. When he called to me Menachem Avil, and I filled him in on the whole story, how my father was sick for 10 years, how he spared us from the knowledge in order to allow us to have a normal childhood, he was blown away. He said to me, until now we knew your father was a tzaddik nigla, a known tzaddik. But now we know that your father was also a tzaddik nister, a hidden tzaddik. And those are the two aspects of my father I want to discuss. The tzaddik nigla and the tzaddik nister. There are many different aspects to my father's godless. His role as a Rebbe, the way he was mechanech the family. His halacha shiurim, the other various shiurim he gave throughout the community. His avas haTorah. His Erlichkeit, and the list goes on and on. But the area that I think I personally gained the most in was his sensitivity towards others and his ability to be noseh be'olam chaveru. My father had a unique ability to feel other people's pain. He would see a situation where someone was being mistreated, going through a hard time, and react differently than others. I clearly remember a number of years ago, I was at a vart in the community, and I stepped outside to get a breath of fresh air. And I saw my father talking to someone from one of the institutions in the community, and they were having an animated conversation, like my father often had. And in the middle, I remember the person turning to my father, and he says to him, "This doesn't affect you. Why are you taking it so personally?" But that was my father. He couldn't tolerate when people were mistreated, or when there was an injustice going on, and he took it personally. And we all know life is very busy. Everyone has their jobs, their families, and the stresses of day-to-day life. So very often when we see someone in pain, we sigh and we walk on. We tell ourselves if we had more energy or more time, we would get involved. We would help the person out. But my father didn't make any cheshbonos. He got involved. He helped the person out. He was there for people. Recently, one of my father's talmidim sent a video of my father speaking at his Sheva Brachos. And as I sat there listening to the vart that my father said over, I couldn't stop thinking how it epitomized my father. In Parshas Vayishlach, by the story of Shechem, when Shimon and Levi wiped out the entire city, Yaakov Avinu comes to them and confronts them, and he asks them, "How could you have done such a thing? What you did was very rash." And the response is very vague. All they say is, "Hachzona yaseh sachosenu." So in the Emes Liakov, Rabbi Yaakov Kamenetsky explains that what Shimon and Levi were saying to Yaakov Avinu was that you're right, what we did may have been rash, but we just couldn't stand by such a thing and not do anything. We had no time for cheshbonos. Like they said, Nevola also be Yisrael. What just happened was intolerable. So other people may walk on, other people may sigh and go back to their own business. But that's not us. And in the Emes Yaakov, Rabbi Yaakov explains that even though in this specific scenario what they did may have been wrong, but this midah is an incredible midah, and the person has to channel it in the proper direction. He says, Befrat for Marbitz Torah, it's very important. But that was my father. He felt other people's pain as if it was his own, and he stood up for it. He didn't make cheshbonos. He didn't care if it was the unpopular position or what people would think of him. He got involved as if it was his own tzar. But incredibly, at the same time, he totally was not makbid on his own kavod. He was a big anav. He was always shocked when he would walk into a shul and they would put him to sit in the front. A number of years ago, someone was giving my father and someone else a hard time about something, and he thought what they were doing was wrong. I was once discussing with him, and he told me, he said, it's okay that they're doing it to me, but it's totally not fair they're doing it to the other person. The other person's such a good person, so erlich, it's not right. But that was my father, so caring and sensitive to other people's feelings and kavod, but yet so not makbid on his own. And he tried very hard to instill this value in us. The Divrei Torah he'd give by the Shabbos table, about Ben Adam L'Chavero, how you have to stand up for what's right, even if it's unpopular, how important it is to be a yashar, and being sensitive to others and not talking behind their backs. There are many speakers tonight. You'll hear many more aspects of my father's known godless. But being a family member and a son, we're the only really ones who know about the hidden tzikus of my father. By now, most of you know about the tremendous chesed they did for us, my parents did for us the past 10 years. But you don't know the full extent of my father's hidden tzidkus. And although I'm here to be matzav with my father, everything I say applies equally to my mother. She stood alongside him all the years and gave him the chizuk and the care that he needed. After my father was diagnosed, approximately 10 years ago, and after consulting with Das Torah, my parents made one of the biggest decisions of their lives, to keep the medical situation private, to protect us. But that wasn't the hard part. Many people may have decided to do such a thing. The hard part was carrying through with it. My father had to work to continue his role in the family, the yeshiva, the community, always smiling, always there for us, and always present in the moment. And there are many different midos my father needed to be able to do this. Tremendous simchas achayim, tremendous mesiris and dedication to others, and tremendous emunah and bitachon. My father would always tell the family and guys in yeshiva that when you're at someone else's simcha, it's your achrayus to do what the Baal Simcha wants. To be where he wants, to act the way he wants, and to dance when he wants. 2 years ago, I was at one of my cousin's bar mitzvah, and my parents came in for the Shabbos and the bar mitzvah. And I noticed that when they started the music, some of my family members were not dancing, including my father. So naturally, I was a little bit shocked. My father always talks about how you have to do what the Baal Simcha wants. So not wanting to be chutzpahdik, I went over to my father, and I said, why is it that some of the family members aren't dancing? I didn't say that I was questioning him. And I don't remember his reply, but I do remember he came over to dance. And I never really thought much of this story. But based on the information I now know, it's a totally different story. At the time of the bar mitzvah, the treatment that my father was undergoing had a side effect that he did not have sensation in his legs for an extended period of time. And that bar mitzvah happened to fall out during that period of time. So my father was sitting on the side because he had no sensation in his legs. It was hard for him to dance. My mother said they were put up in a house a 5-minute walk away from where the shul and the meals were, and it took them 45 minutes to walk home. So really what was expected of my father was to be sitting on the side, not to be dancing. And it would have been easy for my father to tell me, Yaakov Hillel, I have a situation here. I don't have sensation in my legs. I have a medical condition that you're unaware of. And I wouldn't have had any questions. I would have walked away feeling quite stupid. But he didn't do that. In order to protect us, he got up and he came over and he danced. Similar story, before I got married a month ago, I needed insurance for my car. So obviously I turned to my father, he was the one who managed these type of things. And I approached him a few weeks before the chasana to take care of it. And as some of you may know, he spent a week in a special treatment center here, so he was unable to take care of it. So a few days before my chasen, I still had no car insurance. I didn't expect my father to take care of it. So 2 days before my chasen, my parents went to visit his doctor, and it was a little bit of a trip. And my father spent the entire ride on the phone with Geico, arranging car insurance for me. He could have spent the time to relax, to talk to my mother. He could have said, I'm in too much pain. I just need to rest a little bit. But no, my father always put us first. In all situations, we were always put ahead of him. Throughout my dating and engagement, my father was always there for advice, different hashkafic and halachic questions, whenever I wanted. He never said he's too tired, he's in too much pain, or he just needed some time for himself. He spent hours on the phone with me, and it's not just me. If you ask any of my siblings, it was the same for each and every one of them. 2 days after my wedding, we drove out to the hospital, and we spent hours talking to my father, singing wedding songs, and davening. Naturally, it was very hard for my siblings, my wife, and I to leave my father and go home for Shabbos Shavuot Brachos. But my father insisted that most of us go back, only a few stayed, because he didn't want his sickness to shter our simcha. And it wasn't just the family my father put first, it was also the Talmidim. On Purim, my father really wasn't feeling well. He was in bed most of the day. When people came to give him shalach manos, he was unavailable. But when it came time for the Suda and to be Mesamech with the Talmidim, he got out of bed, and to the amazement of my mother, he was there in the yeshiva for the entire Suda, and he even danced with the Talmidim. When he was originally diagnosed, my father felt the need to tell one of his very close chaverim, as he thought it would be a good source of chizuk for him. However, after talking it over with my mother and thinking about it for a while, I decided to keep it private to protect us. But when a few years ago, one of my father's Talmidim had a medical crisis of his own, and my father thought that it would give the Talmud chizuk to know about my father's situation, my father told him. He didn't tell those who he would benefit from telling. He told those that would benefit from knowing. My father also had tremendous bitachon. For those who were at my chasana, they saw my father was in a wheelchair. He was too weak to be walking around. With the advice of his doctors, he greatly enjoyed the wedding with the knowledge that he would start yet another chemo regimen after the wedding. So naturally, my father was planning on walking me down the aisle. He was planning on dancing with me. The day of my wedding came, he was walking around. He walked to the car to drive to Muncie, where the chasana was. And when he arrived in Muncie, he was too weak to walk. They had to put him in a wheelchair. Imagine the frustration a regular person would have. All of a sudden, unable to walk your oldest son down the chuppah, not being able to dance with him. And everyone coming to the wedding and being shocked to see him that way. There was definitely room for tainas. Why is Hashem doing this to me? Why do I deserve it? But not my father. When he pulled me aside before I went for pictures, and he reassured me that the doctor said he would be okay, which they believed until close to the patira, he smiled and told me, Hashem has a good sense of humor. No tainas, no complaints, just a smile and a chuckle. And the same was true in the ICU. When he was missing his oldest son, Shavuot Brachos, and he was hooked up to a dozen different machines, he once again talked about Hashem's sense of humor, always with a smile. My mother told me that my father would often say he has no tainas. Hashem gave him such an incredible life, and the fact that he has a serious medical condition didn't change the hakaras hatov he had at all. He told my mother how Rabbi Yisrael said that if there was a store where a person could buy Yisurim, that you should go ahead and buy Yisurim, because that's the biggest kapara. 10 years, never a word of complaint. Who could have done such a thing? But that was my father. And this is just the beginning of his tzidkus. So there was 1 year, around Pesach time, that the chemo treatment that he was currently on made it that everything he ate tasted bitter. Most people going into Yantif would be frustrated that they couldn't enjoy the delicious Yantif food. But not my father. He recently told my sister that he was very nervous that he wouldn't be able to have the shiurim by the siddurim. He wouldn't be able to be yotzei the mitzvah. Baruch Hashem, he said he was able to, but he was not yotzei a single other suda the entire Yantif because he was never able to eat enough to be yotzei. And he told her he was so besimcha he was able to do the mitzvah. Who would have such a perspective to not be frustrated, but to rather focus on the chesed Hashem that he was able to do the mitzvah? It's been a little over 4 weeks since I found out what my father was actually going through these past 10 years. As time goes on and we have more time to reflect, many more stories of my father's strength, determination, and godliness will come out. This is just the beginning. In the hospital, my father kept saying, "This is a lesson for what you do for your children." I hope that we can all learn from my father and that one day I can be just a fraction of who my father really was. Yehi zichro baruch.
I'd like to call now Mr. Chaim Sharfman.
With these last few weeks, I was sitting thinking back about my father. And I had tons of different memories and amazing thoughts about him. And one of the things that really struck me was that I was thinking that my father was always so dedicated and so devoted to each and every one of his children's ruchnis, tikkun gashmis, tikkun needs. All he cared about was that our needs were taken care of. And I always look back and I'm amazed but what my father did. I remember that when I wasn't happy in yeshiva, my father spent hours upon hours talking to different people to figure out what to do and what would be the best option for me for the coming year. He took all his personal preferences out of it and just looked what would be the best for me and what I wanted and what I needed. When it came time for Fahares, he dropped everything and flew out with me to go check out the yeshiva and see what it was like. He spent a full day there, checking the place out, talking to different rabbeim and bachrim, just to see if it would be the right place for me. And when it came time to make a decision, he took me out, not to make a decision for himself, to make a decision, to help me make a decision. And we spent hours and hours discussing every single aspect. He took my opinions and thought seriously. It wasn't a decision, oh, where am I going to send my son? It was a decision, what would my son do the best? He always wanted what was best for me, not what was necessarily what was best for him. Before I went out of town, like any normal kid, I used to learn with my father. But when I left the house, my father didn't want us to lose that. And almost every single night for 3 years, past 3 years I was away, my father used to call me, I used to call him, and we used to learn on the phone. And he tried his hardest to juggle his schedule to make everything work out. And even when there were many times I would call, and he would tell me that, oh, I don't necessarily have time right now, but he never said no. It was always, hopefully I'll have time in 5 minutes, call me back in 5 minutes. I had countless rabbeim tell me over these three years that they were so amazed that a father could spend so much time every single week on the phone with his son, even though he was so busy. And I still remember thinking to myself that what's the big deal? Everyone would do it. My father just made it so obvious that this is the right thing. This is what you do. But the truth is, it was a big deal. And my father went beyond his call and really, really did what was best for us. Learning with my father every single night gave me real insight into my father's ideas and terror. There were countless times that I'll be learning on the phone with him, having a heated argument, only to realize that while we were busy hacking Rishonim and Achronim, he was also busy shopping in Publix or taking care of other things. I will always be amazed at how he would be sitting there telling me over all the important Rishonim and Achronim on the sugya and pointing out specific Rashis and Tosafim that I had missed, all while walking down the aisles of Publix. All my father cared about was our learning. I still remember when I wasn't happy in yeshiva, my father called me into his office one day, sat me down, and looked at me and said, "What do I have to do so you'll stay in learning as long as possible? Whatever it takes, I'll do." That's all he wanted. He wanted us just to sit and learn and become Bnei Torah. He always used to tell me that when it comes to buying Sfarim, there's no budget. Whatever it is that's going to make you learn any safer, anything you ever wanted, Sfarim-wise, there's no question. You don't have to call. All he wanted was that we should grow. And he wanted us each to have big avos haTorah. He once told one of my brothers, Rabbi, that all I want from is that my son should have avos haTorah. And that's what counts. And it's not his grades, not necessarily what he's going on the tests and different things. It was just have avos haTorah, come out with avos haTorah. Whenever it was time to make a big decision, either my siblings going to seminary or yeshivas, my father would always take us out to a fancy restaurant to discuss it, to show us the importance of a decision. It wasn't just a yeshiva decision that you sit down in your living room and decide. It's a big decision in life. And the yeshiva was very important, and seminary was important. Whenever he had an opportunity for us to see a gadol, he'd go running. I still remember when I went there to Yisrael, he brought us all over to all the gadolim. But one memory that really struck me was that we walked one Shabbos across the entire Yerushalayim, just that he could show us Rabbi Yashiv making a Havdalah, God Ador, to show us real Avos haTorah. I remember as a kid that we learned about Avos Habonim, there were many, many times he used to pull out money from his wallet and offer it to me and tell me if I could really explain what we were learning or if I knew an answer to a question, then he would give it to me. Another thought that comes to mind when I was thinking about my father was how much he wanted us to understand what we learned. And not just to be able to say things over, but really understand. When I was a little kid in elementary school, I used to come home every week with a Divrei Torah, a paper that every teacher gave out. And I remember every Friday night when I would say it, after I would say it over, he would turn to me and say, "Now turn the paper over and see if you could say it in your own words." Even a little kid, Divrei Torah, it was important that we should understand and really realize what we were doing and not just read it. I one time heard a shir for some certain class of person, and one of the points he said I didn't really understand. And I was with my father, but and I was telling him, and I remember I was scared to go over to this person, start hacking him up in front of the whole place. And something my father said that day I'll remember forever. He said that if someone said Torah and put it out there, you've every right in Chiv to hack him up just so that you understand it. He always pushed us to really understand. He didn't want us just to be able to say over the Vart. He wanted us to understand it. But all while he catered to our ruchnis and needs, My father was also there for all our Gashmi's needs. He was the one who took us shopping for candy for camp. He insisted that we have the best stuff and always enough to share with our friends. And always when we thought we were done, he would sit there convincing us that we need more stuff and more stuff for camp, different things. I'll forever be impacted by how he put his chashivas aside and just did what he had to do. When I was younger, he used to come outside when he came home for supper and used to come out and play catch with me, practice baseball. And he didn't just do what he had to do. He didn't just come out, put on a glove, and pretend to throw around the ball for a minute. He would get down on the floor and let me practice pitching to him, and he would really get involved. Nothing was beyond his dignity when it came to his kids. He used to drive out to come to watch us play baseball in our leagues. I still remember before the season started, he would always take us to make sure we had the best glove and the best cleats and everything possible that we needed. Years ago, one of my brothers was playing in a baseball league that I wasn't from, and the coach would schedule many of the practices on Shabbos. And along with the practices came a trip to the batting cages. My father didn't want my brother to feel like he was missing out, because he was doing the right thing. So my father would take him every single week, sometime during the week, to the batting cages, and not only let him get into the batting cages and walk away, my father would sit there and coach him and help him out, just so that he wouldn't feel like he was missing out because he was doing the right thing. A lot of people do these things just because they have to. But that's not what my father did. He showed a genuine interest into anything that we were interested in. And he didn't pretend, he really cared. My father was an Adam Godel, but it didn't stop him from being a father. This was my father, a man who had tremendous office of Torah, went to great lengths to instill it within each of us, and all while making us feel that we were so precious and so special to him. And he went to great lengths to show this to us. I now want to read a letter from my sisters, my father. Many people will discuss Abba's role as a Talmud Chacham, a Rebbe, a Mashkiach, and a community leader. And as his children, we would like to offer our perspective on the loving and incredible presence that Abba was and will always be in our home. Firstly, we will never forget the laughter and the simcha and the togetherness that we felt when sitting and schmoozing with Abba. Most often that took place at the Shabbos table, in the study, or in our parents' room. So many of our friends texted us and called us to be Menachem Avil and mentioned the incredible impact that Abba had sitting at the head of the Shabbos table, leading the meal. Some were there once and others weekly, but they all had incredible memories to share. Often stocked with nash, we ate, sang, and schmoozed. Every week, by the Suda, Abba gave an incredible, deep, and beautiful vart from the Parsha that somehow always ended with a lesson for us to clean our rooms and speak with Derech Eretz to Mami. Our conversations usually centered around different gedolim and yeshivas that had a tremendous impact on the Torah world. Our Shabbos table would grow, and by the end of the meal, the table would be packed with our friends and different people from the community. We talked and discussed Jewish history, current events, different issues, and he always gave us third perspective on the world. When we traveled to Eretz Yisrael as a family, he showed us all the different gedolim with the excitement and ahava for Eretz Yisrael. He took us to daven at the kfarim to walk the streets of history. The one time we were in California for bar mitzvah, and as we were standing in the redwood forest, amazed at the height of the trees, all he said to us was he was amazed by the fact that the height of the trees, trying to imagine how Moshe Rabbeinu felt when he was having Mucham with Oig, and how Dovid HaMelech felt when he was having Mucham with Golias. Abba made Torah and Yiddishkeit an inseparable part of our lives, an exciting part of our lives. At night, Abba was available to learn Ramban with us, to hack Ashkafa, to schmooze, to practice driving, or just to take us to Walgreens to stock up on Zowers. He always went to our parent-teacher conferences and saved our report cards from every semester in his filing cabinet. He was always available for each of us to answer any shiloh we might have at any time of day or night. But he didn't just pask in the shilohs for us. He discussed the shiloh and brought us all the proofs, often opening up svarim to say it straight from the source. He repeated over similar shilohs that he discussed with Rabbanim and instilled in us the importance of being medaktik and halacha. Equally important is the determination that was such an incredible part of Abba's character. His determination to spread Torah and inspire people is evident to all. But in the final weeks of his life, it became clear to us just how determined he was in regard to our family and in the face of receiving a diagnosis 10 years ago. Abba was determined to continue on, to lead our family, to be mechanech us, to be with us and involved in all our milestone events. In this year alone, Abba was at a grandson's bris, pidin haben, a son's vart, and as usual, the Beis Yaakov post-production party that lasts all night in our house. He was by everything. Abba made sure that we went to camp and seminary in these 10 years. He was determined to allow us to marry B'nai Torah, and he was willing to foot the bill as well. And finally, Abba was determined to attend Yaakov Hill's wedding. All of us children agreed that Abba looked so genuinely happy and composed at the wedding. He told my brother at the Bedekin, "I feel like jumping out of the wheelchair and going to give the Kala a bracha." Hatzala members told my family that they never met such a person that was so composed and so in control while he was in such pain. During his last Shabbos in the ICU, Abba couldn't stop discussing all the interesting halachas of Shabbos that are unique in the hospital, specifically Amir Lakum. He constantly showed us his love for halacha and his unbelievable Mesiris Nefesh for Shmiras HaMitzvahs. By Mincha time, he told us that he wanted to give a Musar Shmuz and continued to be Mechanichas even though he was an unimaginable tsar sitting in the ICU. Abba, you loved us, you inspired us, and you taught us how to think. None of this will or can ever be forgotten. Our love for you will continue to grow as the time passes. Please be a melech yosher for our family and continue to provide for us like you always have. Yei zecher baruch.
From the moment that this askara was being planned and I was speaking to the family, trying to figure out how to present a program that would not be too many speakers, the first thing I heard is that Avram Mordechai is speaking. That was the first thing they told me. Avram Mordechai said he's speaking, so he was on the list first. So it's my kavod gadol to call up one of the star fourth graders of Torah Semes, Avram Mordechai Sharfman.
It has been so comforting to spend time with my older brothers and sisters and hear their thoughts and stories about Abba. I'm proud to have an opportunity to share my feelings and memories as Abba's youngest child in our wonderful family. In Torah Semes, I have been busy learning Chumash and Mishnayos. Abba would make time to learn with me and often quiz me on my learning. I knew, though, that it was more important to him to see that I was trying than always getting the right answer. When I needed an explanation, Abba would patiently teach it to me. I remember how a little while ago, I made a siyum on Maseches Tainis. Abba helped me say the Hadron and then turned on some music and sang and danced with me. I felt like it was his biggest simcha that I made that siyam. When we sat down and enjoyed a steak dinner that my mother prepared, now as I join in learning Mishnayos L'Zecher Nishmas Abba, and in the future when I will make more siyamim, those special moments and memories with Abba will always be in my mind and heart. Abba was a great schmoozer and made things like long car rides fun. He loved spending time with us. I also remember and appreciate the many special things that he would buy for me, including some great nash. Whenever we went somewhere with Abba, we were enjoying and we were learning. He knew so much Torah and history and general information, and he loved to share it with us. I miss Abba's love for all of us in our family, his Torah presence and knowledge that inspired me and made me so happy, and my special time learning with my amazing Abba. I hope to follow my father's footsteps and grow to be a Talmud Chacham and a Mensch so that I can make Hashem, my father, and all Klal Yisrael proud of me. Yehi Zichro Baruch.
Thank you, everyone. You did a great job. Thank you. It's now our covered gadol to call upon our Rashiva, Rav Binyamin Luban, Shlita.
Rishus, the Rabbanim, family.
I'm sorry, I'd like to ask the people who are in the back, there are still more seats in the men's section in the front on downstairs here, so please don't be bashful, come up, there are many more seats in the front. We would like everyone to be able to have a seat. Don't be bashful, we're taking a moment to get everybody seated.
I must admit, I feel very inadequate to speak. In general, I felt inadequate, and shortly after the three boys, it's very, very difficult. There is a chazal, it's a medrash, it's brought in Rashi in last week's parsha in Shmini, that after Dathan and Aviram were killed, so Moshe told Aaron, Yodeani Hayisi Shiz Kadesh Abayas Bimiyodav Shamakom. I knew that someone was going to be killed for Yisi Soiver Obio Bach, but I thought it would be either me or you. Akshav Roa Anishem Gedoidim Meni Mimcha. Now I realize that they were greater than both of us. Very difficult chazal. What does it mean they were greater than Moshe? Well, come to Yisrael, come Moshe. But it definitely means that on some dimension, in some area, Moshe was saying that they're greater. And it's a fascinating Rashi, a chazal. Moshe Rabbeinu is the Memtesh Shari Chochma. Moshe Rabbeinu with Dasan Aviram all the time. He's their Rebbe. He's considered a Kilo Yoldo, nephews. Didn't Moshe Rabbeinu understand their Madrega? And it seems that Moshe Rabbeinu is saying that he never really fathomed how great they were until after they died, based on this Maisa. Akshav Roa Nishem Gedoidim Imeni Memcha. I'm sure it meant that Moshe beforehand also appreciated them. He also, to hear that he was standing, they were gedolim. But the extent of the godless, he did not appreciate. And hard to know, it doesn't say why, it just says, but it's very possible it's because when you're in the presence of godless and you live with godless And the person who has gathers does it so nonchalant and so easy. It just seems like it's just flowing, no effort. So it's very hard to appreciate it. When a person seems it's difficult, oh, you notice, wow, the Mesiras Nefesh. But when a person just does it without almost without any effort, so it's very hard to be machshev. Perhaps that's why, don't know. But what I do know is just as Moshe Rabbeinu to not appreciate fully the godless Tosan Vavirim, surely, Kavachoymer, Ben Benosho, Kavachoymer, myself, I think the Bnei Yeshiva, perhaps everybody, we really did not appreciate Rabbi Sharpen's godless sufficiently. I don't want to say we didn't appreciate him. We did appreciate him. We were much of him. We respected him. We had tremendous respect. But to the extent that really he deserved, I'm sure we were lacking. As was mentioned, Rabbi Sharfman was a multifaceted personality. Many, many Midas, many we heard already. I decided just to focus, as also was mentioned, can't speak about everything, on two or three points that were, I think, very, very unique, special. I found them very inspiring. There's a Mishnah in Pirkei Avos, Rav Yochanan ben Zakkai asked his Talmidim, Eizu derech toiva sheyidbek baha adam. The Avos Rav Nosson, the Gir says, Eizu derech toiva sheyidbek baha adam kidei shikonis baha adam haba. And we know that Rav Ozer says, Leiv tov. And Rav Yochanan ben Zakkai said, Royani is divrei Rav Ozer ben Aruch, that Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai came out in Paskin that there was a Leiv Tov. The question is, why is Leiv Tov so important? And it seems fascinating. Seems to be perhaps a machloikas, probably Eidu ve'Eidu. The Bartanura says a simple reason, because the leiv is what determines your actions. When a person has a leiv tov, a leiv hu amir nechol shara koiches. Person, the leiv is what causes every action as a result of the leiv. So when a person has a leiv tov, he automatically has good actions. But the Aven Ezra in Dvarim says a different shot. He says, because in the etzem fakir, the actions are only for the lave. It's not the lave for the actions. It's the actions for the lave. Rachmana liba boy. The ikar is the lave. So that lave serves a dual function. Lave helps us do actions. Without a lave, one doesn't have action. And the lave itself is intrinsically is the most important midah. It's what Hashem wants. Just those feelings at heart. There's a piece by the Rav Chatzko where he writes how even a dakas in leiv makes a tremendous difference. Chatzkel, where he said over, he told his Talmidim, Rav Chatzkel, he was in America after the war, he went and left, and he went to Eretz Yisrael. And he almost like ran away from America. And he said as follows, why is he running away from America? Ki ikar achilukim hayoim bein adam poshet adam gado hu ber hergish. If you want to know the difference between a gadol and a plain person, it's the hergish, the lave, the feeling. Mashu margish hergish haruchni ksas yoser mi hasheni. Person who has a little bit more feeling, that's the godless. Vahevdo lepomim hu kichut asayra. If you could just have a chut asayra means a hear. More hargish, you're already a whole different madrega. You're already, that separates. A person with a chutas ara more is already a gadol compared to a person with a chutas ara less. So he said in America, it's very hard to retain his hargash. He's afraid he might lose his hargashas, and therefore he's running away to America. Those who knew Rabbi Sharfman did not just have a chut ha-saira more hargosha than everyone else. Rabbi Sharfman was kulo lev. He was so emotional, so excited. Everything he got involved in, it was with such a lev. Obviously, the Talmidim, care that he had for Talmidim was amazing. Even the Talmidim that gave him the most trouble, the Talmidim that perhaps some people might have thought we should ask him to leave the yeshiva, Rabbi Sharfman always stood up for them. No, got to give him not a second chance, a 15th chance. 20, you know, he was just always, he's such a tremendous lev, care in every single way. He always came in with suggestions how we could go ahead and improve the Talmidim. And he also had a lay for HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He would give Musar. He had his Musar Vadim. Sometimes the guys would call them rants. He wouldn't just give a Musar Vad. He would get into it. And it was just going. He was so emotional. He had such a lave. It was unusual. Very unusual. Remember the Rishiva that Sal used to talk about how the big problem of America is that America, even more than Europe, people have no feelings. Shiva used to talk about how at JFK Kennedy's Levaya, his wife walked with dignity. She didn't show any feelings. And everyone thought it was so wonderful. Because in America, the idolizes no feelings. That's America. He thought how trafe that was. And true, we're brought up in that society, and it affects us, it rubs off on us. Rabbi Sharfman, the Tzau, was a person who had such tremendous, tremendous hargashas. It was amazing. I mentioned to the family, there were times that sometimes we might have had a disagreement of opinions on Hoa meeting, but I think any time we had a disagreement, which wasn't that often, but I think I always lost because he was so emotional about his opinion. You couldn't disagree with him. He was just so adamant. This has to be this way. It's okay, if you're so adamant, I'll give in. You know, there's just nothing to talk about. He had such starkeit, such emotional hargosha about everything he believed in. There is a Gemara in Moed Katan, very interesting Gemara. The Gemara says that Rav Yehuda put a certain Talmud Chacham into Cherem, because whatever, he wasn't acting properly. And then soon after, Rav Yehuda got sick in his deathbed. And the people came to visit him, and this Talmud Chacham that Rav Yehuda put in Cherem also came. And it says, it's Gemara Moikotan Yudzayin, that when Rav Yehuda saw him, he smiled. So the person got upset. He said, why are you smiling? It's enough you put me in Cherem. You're like rubbing it in. So Rav Yehuda says, no, I'm not smiling about that. What am I spying at? Because I know I'm going to be Nifter soon. T'chiazlina lahu alma. When I go to the next world, I know I'm on my deathbed, and I'm smiling. Then when I go to God, the next world, b'tchina daitoi, I'm happy. I'm happy that I can walk in on my deathbed, and I can go up to Shemayim, and I say, yeah, this person, he was a prestigious person in the community, was a Talmud Chacham, and I didn't do Chanifa. I told it as it is. He needed to be put in Cherem, I put him in Cherem. So I'm smiling. I'm smiling to know that I stood up for what's right. And when I go to Gan Eden, and I go and have my Betira, I'll be able to say I was honest. And I think that too is really Sharfman. He's now, he can have that simcha. Rabbi Sharfman would always love to the Talmidim, to everyone else. But when it came to giving mussar, he gave mussar. There were guys that sometimes were hurt, maybe where they felt sometimes he was too strong, but they knew that he came, he told it the way it was. He was not, there was no Hanifa. There was no Hanifa. He wasn't a politician. He told it, he did whatever he believed. He said it straight, he said it with emotion, he said it with feeling, he said it stark, and he can say, have this thing that he said, he can also be chayach. When he goes up to Shemayim, he can say that I didn't have no chanifa to any individual. It's an ish emes. There's one other midah which I would like to stop on. There is a medrash in Dvarim, the beginning of Akev. It discusses that the Torah doesn't give to us the schar of mitzvah's essays. And the Medrash says, why not? Why didn't Hashem tell us the schar? And it gives a mashal of a king who made a pardes, trees, an orchard. And if he told, he wanted the people to work in the orchard. And he said, if I would tell you the schar, which tree is more valuable, which tree you get more schar for taking care of, then everyone would just work the more valuable trees and they would ignore the less valuable trees. Therefore, I'm not telling you, so you should do everything. The mashal, the nimsho is Hashem, if he would have told us the schar of the mitzvahs, we would have only done the mitzvahs that are more valuable, the greater reward, we would have left over the mitzvahs that are lesser reward. It's a medrash. The medrash, when you think about it, seems very schwer, because what are we talking about, that the person has time for everything or doesn't have time for everything? If he doesn't have time for everything, then that really is a halacha. There would be nothing wrong with doing the mitzvahs that are greater and not doing the mitzvahs that are less great. That's a halacha. You're supposed to do that. If you have two mitzvahs, a bodhi yatra, and you know one is greater than the other, you're supposed to do the greater one. So apparently the Medrash is talking about a person who has time for everything. So why is it, if we would tell him the schar of the mitzvahs, he wouldn't bother doing the mitzvahs that are smaller? Do you know what the schar of a mitzvah is? Schar of a mitzvah, it says, I mean, the Rabbeinu Yoina, who brings this in of us, he ends up with the center line, but the schar of every mitzvah is ayin lo rasa. The schar of any mitzvah, even the smallest mitzvah, is greater than all the pleasures of Olam Hazeh put together. So if the Torah would have written the schar of mitzvahs, and it would tell us, okay, this is the smallest one, but there's a tremendous schar, and we're not busy, why wouldn't we do it? And what it seems to imply is that human nature is that when you get involved doing mitzvahs that are greater and have tremendous more schar, then psychologically you're just not machshav the less mitzvahs, even though they're worth millions and millions of dollars, or much more than that. But I was doing something worth 100 million, 1,000 million, billion. I'm going to do this. Okay, I have time. But if you're involved with godless, it's just very hard to get involved with things that are smaller. And this midah, Rabbi Sharfman had, that he was involved with everything. So we heard from his family, we heard from the Talmidim. Rabbi Sharfman did everything. He was involved in the things that were the most important. He was giving people advice for life, directing them in life. What could be more important? Show Eitzah, being a mashkiach, helping people make their life decisions. And he was involved in things that were sometimes so trivial. Right? It was mentioned he's in public. What was he doing in public? Could be he was shopping for a home too, I don't know. But he was always shopping for yeshiva also, for the silliest things in yeshiva. Yeshiva, there's a tainus. So yeshiva serves supper. So the boys should know there's going to be a tainus. So be responsible and get yourself some food. No. Rabbi Sharfman would go to the store and buy them cookies. I have to have cookies before Friday comes. What if the boy didn't realize that there's going to be a tainus, or he wasn't responsible enough to buy food? Right? Had to buy cookies. Had to buy him a little chocolate to get him to stay there in the morning. All the almost like nourishkeits. Not nourishkeits, but little things compared when a person's Isaac Bidvaram Ha'im Den Barayim Ha'shal Olam. How can you go ahead, you know, in the yeshiva, Rabbi Sharman had, I guess he had a job, but there was no such thing that it's not my job. I don't think he had such, I ever heard him say such a thing. It's not my job. His job was anything that's not anyone's job is his job. That was, he did anything that had to be done that no one else was doing, whether it was major or minor. I don't know how he had the time for it, especially when you hear how he spent his family and everyone else. But he went ahead and he took care of the most important things, and he took care of all the minor things. And he did them both besimcha, and he didn't lose his chashivas. He didn't say, I'm so busy doing important things, I should waste my time with this nourishkeit. But he did it happily. He found it, he searched for it, and he did it. This was, I think, a very unusual midah. So where does this leave us? I don't really know. There's a hargasha, I feel, I'm not sure if it's halachically right. I don't know if it's the right place. But I have the hargasha that I feel myself, and I think for the Bnei Yeshiva feels, that there's a concept of asking mechila. Really, it's brought in the Shulchan Aruch. You're supposed to ask mechila by the kever. But it is brought down that the meis without a hesped, it's brought down it's a chazal. It could be, I didn't see it, that this, you can be yotzi asking mechila. It's also b'diavet, even not by the kever, according to many people. And I think as a shliach for myself, for the anhoa, for all the Bnei Yeshiva, past, present, and family, I think there's really a hargasha. We have to ask mechila. We didn't act with the proper kavod, derech eretz, or perhaps even worse. And I think we have to ask in public, and I want to act as a shliach for everyone for asking that mechila. I also want to ask for a bracha. It was mentioned in Shemayim, he can do more for us. Hashem, he should be a meidus yosher for all of us. And our responsibility, we also have achrayas. We have an achrayas to get inspired, to learn the lessons, to see the goddess that was there, and to try and emulate it. Obviously, if we go ahead, whatever we do is a schus, that's the achiyuv. It's not just a chiyuv on the children, it's a chiyuv on the talmidim, k'derbonim, it's a chiyuv, whatever you do, whatever we do, it has a schus, and that's really our achrayas, it's a chiyuv that we have to go ahead and to continue to give him schusim, just like we're Be'ez Hashem, he should be a meidus yosher for us, but we have to send him mitzvahs. It's a two-way street, and we really have to stop and think of ways that we can go ahead to do more mitzvahs, can mekabel some of the midas that we hear tonight, what I said, what the family said, what other people said, perhaps other mitzvahs, learning, obviously, any mitzvahs always is appropriate. And in this way, we can go ahead and perhaps return a little bit of the chesed, of the hakaras hatov, that we owe to him.
It's our covered golden now to call upon Rav David Lehrfeld, Rav of the Young Israel Grid in Miami, to address us. Thank you, Rabbi Lehrfeld.
At this moment, I have a feeling of guilt. Every year at Shavuos, at Young Israel, we have a mishmor. And every year we would have Rabbi Sharfman come and give us a shir. Oh, do I feel guilty. Had I known of his situation, do you think I would have bothered him? Do you think I would have said to him, come to our shul and give a shir? But he came year after year, gave a magnificent shir. Magnificent shir. Little did I know the Maseiros Nefesh that he had to come to our shul and give to the shir. Before I continue, I turn to my left and I say the words of Rabbi Akiva, Sheli v'shelochem shelah. Everyone's speaking tonight about Rabbi Sharfman, the greatness, the dignity, the kovod. Rebbetzin Sharfman is the one who gave it to him. And I feel such great chiyuv for us to say once again, Sheli v'shelochem shelah. Everything said about him tonight, everything, is because of the inspiration given to him by his wife. And may Hashem give to her the nechama as only he could give. You know why we're here tonight? Because we have to be here. Chazal tell us there was a magefa in the time of David HaMelech because a proper kovod wasn't given to Shaul when he died. So a magefa came to Shaul HaMelech, to David HaMelech, because he didn't get the proper kovod. And that's why we're here tonight. We're here tonight not because we want to, but because we have to. It is a chiyuv, an obligation, for us to give kovod to an Odom Gadol. And why are we here? Tov le'lecha beis evel, mi'le'lecha beis mishteh. Is what Shlomo Melech says in Koheles. Better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of a simcha. Because in a house of mourning, we concentrate. Yeah, we go through life 24 hours a day, and everything zips over our head. Minutes go, hours go. We don't concentrate. V'achai yitain elibo, when you go to a house of an ovel like we're here tonight, we do concentrate. And we think for a moment, what are the chayuvim that we have? And everyone is speaking about Rabbi Sharfman. I like to pinpoint one particular aspect of him that always touched me. You know, in Pirkei Avos, the last perek, Chazal describes the greatness of an Odom Gadol. Different attributes the Odom Gadol has. And I quote one of the attributes that I felt was Rabbi Sharfman. Umalbaishto bi'anova. The Odom Gadol has garments of modesty. Umalbaishto anova. Every one of us tonight wearing a suit, a jacket, clothing, and we pride ourselves on how we look. We want to look just so. The greatness of the Odom Gadol is that his garment is one of anivus. Speaking to Rabbi Sharfman, the Gadol that he was, the great personality that he was. Did you ever get the feeling of arrogance? Do you ever get the feeling that, oh, look who I am? You ever get the feeling that he looked down upon you? Interesting. Chazal describe the anivas of a person like a suit of clothes that fit him just perfectly. That fit him just perfectly. And there was Rabbi Sharfman. He saw him, had tremendous shtat, tremendous dignity. He spoke in our shul so many times with such chokhmah, such precision, such wisdom. And when you spoke to him, umabashto anova, you never realized the greatness of the man to whom you were speaking. And of all the great things that our Torah describes, Moshe Rabbeinu, it was with the words, V'yoish Moshe Onov Ma'od. That was the greatness of Moshe. And I see the greatness of Rabbi Sharfman was not merely his brilliance or his greatness or his erudition. It was the garment of Anivas that he wore so well. You know, I'm going to finish with a pasuk in Yirmiyahu. Pasuk that I think we should all know. Al tifka lameis, b'chol sivka laholech. Don't cry for the one who has gone. Rabbi Sharfman is now giving shiurim in the Mesitra Shomaila. Rabbi Sharfman is giving shiurim that are being listened to by all the great chazal of our time. And they're listening to his shiurim with the same rapt attention that we did. Don't cry for him. You want to cry? You cry for us, for what we have lost. But as everyone knows, V'achai yitain el libo, we are here tonight to concentrate and to say to ourselves, thank you, Ribono Shel Olam, for giving that man to us. Thank you, Ribono Shel Olam, for giving us such a Moreh Derech. And alavai, we should have the chokhmah to walk out of this medrash better people, because he was with us and Hashem gave him to us. Yehei Zichro Baruch.
If anyone just walked in, I just want to mention there are more seats in front. If anyone's looking for seats, the front of the top section, and also there are seats scattered about down here. It's now our kavod gadol to call upon Rav Ephraim Eliyahu Shapiro, the Rav of Shari Tefillah. Our kavod, Rabbi Shapiro.
There have been so many people who have spoken until now, and after me there are still many people who will be speaking. Everyone has been, to say that everyone has been so inspiring almost seems like a silly comment. What I actually felt as I listened to everyone was asking myself, and I would hope that when you're in a room with so many hundreds and hundreds of men and women, you did exactly what I did. Did you ask yourself how we're doing? How our midos are? How we behave? How we interact? Every person that I listened to, the Rosh HaYeshiva, the Rabbanim, the children, I found myself doing a lot of thinking. And I'd have to believe that if you have so many hundreds upon hundreds of men and women, every human being with a beating heart in this room did the same thing. And as they heard everything about her, Dovid Sharfman, Zatzal, thought about those midos and wondered how we could become better. Now I know that many people have spoken and will speak and all touched upon different nekudos. There's one nekuda that I want to touch upon. It hasn't yet been spoken about, and it could be to the degree that I'm going to mention it, the family is unaware. After all, they were, Baruch Hashem, involved, of course, first with the chasana, and then with the week in the hospital. And it could also be that many people who flew in tonight, I heard countless people flew in, are certainly unaware. And it could even be people in our own kehillah are unaware. But if a person was a Rav in this community a month ago, if a person was a Rav, a rabbi, a leader, then you were aware of what I'm about to talk about. How else would you explain the most surreal number of phone calls coming in at all times of day and night during that week? I'm talking about the week that they thought, we thought, would bring a refuah shalema. Rabbanim got called 2 a.m. with people sobbing. We are paralyzed. We are numb. What do we do? In my humble opinion, there's one pasuk in Rashi that when I was thinking about Harav David Sharfman Zatzal today, I said, this pasuk is it. When Aaron the Kohen Gadol passed away, the pasuk tells us in Chukas Chof Choftes, Aaron passed away, and the pasuk says, Vayifku, they cried and they grieved and they were shattered. Kol Beis Yisrael. The Iker Sifsei Chachamim makes a big deal out of telling us you will rarely, if ever, find the word Kol Beis Yisrael. Kol Beis Yisrael, take a look at Rashi, why don't you? Kol Beis Yisrael, Zok Rashi, means there wasn't a man, a woman, or child who wasn't shattered and grieving. You can look at the words of Rashi yourself. For the family who wasn't here during that week, 4 weeks ago, for all the Talmidim who flew in, and for those who weren't part of the South Florida community, let me tell you what it was like. How else could you explain thousands and thousands? You know, sometimes you want to know, forgive me for digressing a minute, what does a person mean to you? What did Rabbi Sharfman Zatzal mean to us? I'll tell you what Rabbi Sharfman meant to us. How else could you explain that there were countless of the girls and the women during that week communicating through texting, finishing Sefer Tehillim, and I understand the number in that week was well over 100 times, Sefer Tehillim. I myself saw, wherever I was, whether it was in my family or anywhere else, any person with a beating heart who had a free second, say some Tehillim. You ever saw how many Bachrim here a month ago? You're lucky if you do that the first night Shavuos. The family should be aware of how many bachrim here in the yeshiva and in the kollel pulled all-nighters a few nights in a row. There were sites that were created for people to take upon themselves. Beis Yaakov created it, Kabbalos, specifically in the area of Tznius. There were unprecedented tzedakah campaigns. And perhaps the thing we were sure would work, at least I was, when hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of little kids, Tinaikai Shel Beis Rabban, gathered in the Kailo to hear a thundering message from Rabbi Glatt, and then to say Tehillim as only children can. I was sure that was it. How could it not be? This Kehila spent a week between the hundreds of times finishing Sefer Tehillim, the Kabbalos, the Tzedakah campaigns, the all-nighters, the Tinaika Shel Beis Rabban. The Pasuk said what we went through. Kol Hashchuna, Kol HaKehila. There's not a man, woman, or child, Anashim, Nashim, V'taf, Bachurim, Bachurais, Yelodim, and Yelodais. The way you know how you feel about a person is when that happens in a week. I made it clear when I spoke to the family, some of the family a couple of days ago, I had to announce in shul on a Friday morning a few weeks ago that it's over. In fact, Rabbi Glatt, you were there, I remember. And one of the mispalalim said, oh, last night at Tehillim, Rabbi Sharfman's son was in the back yelling and screaming and davening, and now it's over. I said to the balabos, his name is David, I said, David, what are you talking about? He said, yeah, last night in the back when the whole shul said Tehillim, Rabbi Sharfman's son in the back was yelling and screaming. It was gut-wrenching. I said, David, Rabbi Sharfman's sons are in New York in the ICU by their father. I had to explain to him that the person you saw, like, he couldn't chalom. If anybody is so gut-wrenched with sobbing, it's got to be a son, isn't it? Well, yeah, there are thousands of those. I made it clear in the shul on that Shabbos Haggadah. I know he was a mashkiach par excellence. In fact, I understand who is the quintessential mashkiach. But I made it clear in shul to the balabatim. He was every one of our, he was our Rebbe. He was a Rebbe to every one of the balabatim in all of the shuls and all the schools. He just had that ability. And that's why, if you remember in our Shabbos, in one of the Shabbos Haggadol Drushas, I said, after consulting with Gedolim, they told me, while it's forbidden on that Shabbos to be maspid, it's equally forbidden not to address what happened to Rabbi Sharfman and to Kol Beis Yisrael. He was our Rebbe, period. And that's mamish what Rashi says about Aaron. It's one of the only times you'll find Anoshim and Noshim, Bachurim and Bachurois, Yelodim and Yelodois. I can't even tell you the countless calls that I referred to earlier, and I'm sure all the Rabbanim got the same phone calls. What do we do? We're like paralyzed. This entire kehila, entire shchuna, was looking for more beyond the Tinaika Shel Beis Rabban, beyond the Kabbalos, beyond the Tznius, beyond the Tzedakah, beyond the learning all-nighters, beyond the 100 times Sefer Tehillim. It can't end this way. as Rabbi Reisman from Torah V'Das said recently about a similar type of situation. This did not end the way we thought it would end. Personally, I was sure after that night of the children, my own children coming home, I was like, that did it. We're all right now. As Rabbi Reisman, the Rosh Hashiva of Torah V'Das, says, it didn't end the way that we and the family and Klal Yisrael thought it would end. But at least let it end the way the Ribbono Shel Olam now wants. And what does that mean? Rabbi Luban, the Rosh Hashiva, a few minutes ago said so eloquently. I remember his words. He just spoke. Rabbi Luban said, and now what? You want to do it for yourselves? Fine. But you should really do it for Mrs. Sharfman and her family. I'll end by telling you, in my opinion, if somebody meant so much to Klal Yisrael, what I think the and now what is. My father, Harav Mordechai Shapiro Zatzal, always quoted a Chassam Sofer that I'll give you the elevator pitch. Dovid HaMelech, like our Dovid HaMelech of a month ago, was about to leave the world, and he called his children over, like you heard the children say there, Dovid HaMelech did, and he starts his last will and testament. We call it a tzava'a. And in his tzava'a, he said, Anoichi hoylech baderech, I'm about to leave. And then he listed about 12 things he wanted the children to do. The Chassam Sofer says, I don't get it. Anoichi hoylech baderech is a nice intro. I'm about to leave this world. Shouldn't the intro precede and be before the tzava'a? Anoichi hoylech baderech, so listen up here. Now I'll tell you what I want. It's not part of the tzava'a. Must have heard this from my father's atzal 1,000 times. How appropriate that Dovid HaMelech said it when we could say we came together for our Dovid HaMelech. Dovid HaMelech was telling his kids, his family, the Kehila, that when you're alive, you're a Hoylech, you could grow. But in the next world, the show's over, you become an Oymed. Oh, but actually there's one way to remain a Hoylech even after you leave this world. If people will become better and people will realize they have to improve, then that has the ability to transform the neshama to not merely be a stationary Oymed, but to go back to being a Hoylech. Says the Heilige Chassam Sofer Zechusa Yagan Aleinu, when Dovid HaMelech was about to leave this world and he started his tzava'a, Anoichi Hoylech Baderech was not an intro, by the way, I'm about to leave. Says the Chassam Sofer, he was telling his Kehila, Anoichi Hoylech Baderech, keep me a Hoylech. I'm going to a place where the show's over and most people become an Oymed. Keep me a Hoylech. The rest of the tzava you could read later. The most important part of what I got to tell you is Anoichi Hoylech Baderech. You got to keep me a Hoylech, said Dovid HaMelech. Because that's all you got. Is that possible? Be'ezras Hashem, maybe to what Rabbi Luban said, you want to know, and now what? If we came because our Dovid HaMelech, Harav Dovid Sharfman Zatzal, we could do something, then let it be Anoichi Hoylech Baderech. I know a lot of people, you tell you, and they may even say to the family, Masha lo yaseh haseichel yaseh hazman. That's true to a degree. But don't abuse those words. The family can make their own decisions. Mashalo yasa seichel yasa hazman is something that people could decide in terms of grieving. It does not mean forgetting or not changing or keeping Rabbi Sharfman's neshama for perpetuity alive. Don't let anybody tell you that mashallah yasa seichel yasa hazman applies to that. It doesn't. I'm telling you, don't ever forget. And whatever you feel tonight, don't let it ever become watered down or weakened at all. I can't tell you what to do. There are great people in the room. Ask them. The thing I told people today, he was the quintessential mashgiach. In many ways, he was a walking Musar Sefer. He had all the midas you're supposed to have. So, Nu, let's learn Musar in his memory. The women could learn it with each other, over the phone, in a small group or class setting. We could have a chabura, we could have a shir. Pick whatever sefer you want. But you see, when you learn what he lived every day, you don't forget. And I'm sure we're here to remind ourselves, don't forget. Because if you want to know what our David HaMelech meant to us, it was Vayifku Kol Beis Yisrael, Anoshim Noshim V'taf. And in this chus, that we are smart enough to learn and live the way that he did, maybe even leave here feeling a little bit inadequate at what a towering giant he was. I know I do. It's good to feel inadequate and ask yourself what you could do, because the good news is, Rabbi Isai, that the last words of that Haftarah where David says, please keep me a Heilech. You know what the last four words are? Five, excuse me. Yechi Adoni HaMelech David La'aylam. David lives forever. Says the Ksav Sofer, the Ksav Sofer's son, can anybody live forever? Some people die in their 50s. Says the Ksav Sofer, based on his father's words, while the family doesn't stop grieving, and while the only person who could truly, the only being that can truly give nechama to Mrs. Sharfman and her children is the Ribbono Shel Olam. But, says the Ksav Sofer, if you keep our Harav David Sharfman's Atzal alive and make sure that tonight he remains a Heilech, then you could tell yourself one thing. Yechi Adoni HaMelech David La'olam. It's possible. That's my understanding of now what. We could never properly express to the family what Rabbi Sharfman Zatzal meant to our entire Shchuna, Kehila, and Klal Yisrael. He was a Rebbe to everybody. Klal Yisrael was his yeshiva. Be'ezras Hashem, the family will take nechama in knowing that we will do everything we can, whether it's in the area of learning Musar or improving in something we've been inadequate until till now, le'ilui his neshama. And that Be'ezras Hashem, the hundreds and hundreds of people who came tonight to fulfill anoichi hoilech baderech, someone who helped transform a community that was grieving and turned out in the pouring we mentioned earlier, let us be zoicha, we owe it to him. Yechi Adoni HaMelech David La'olam. Yehi Zichrei Baruch.
Before I call up the next speaker, I just want to, just a moment of introduction. When I met Rabbi Sharfman, I believe we were in seventh grade together. He was 11 years old and he was saying Kaddish for his mother, Aleha Shalom. And I know from the years how close he was with his sisters and brothers-in-law. And before I call up one of his brothers-in-law to speak, I just wanted everyone to understand this is not a token speech from a side of the family. This was a lifeline for him for all the years. So I'd like to call up Reb Yecheskel Skrifonsky, fondly known as Uncle Yecheskel.
Not so very long ago, a battle was raging. Not some small local skirmish. I'm talking about a battle of epic proportions. You didn't read about it in the New York Times, and you didn't hear about it on CNN. But the battle raged. A battle between heaven and earth. And when I say heaven, I'm not talking about what you see out there with your telescopes. I'm talking about a heaven that goes infinitely far beyond the outer reaches of the cosmos. It was a battle between heaven and earth. For the soul of Harav Dovid, Baruch Dovid Aryeh, Ben Harav Nosson Dov. Arrayed on the side of heaven were the Malachim Hamoini Malo, celestial beings of unimagined might and majesty. Here on earth, were arrayed the weak and the frail. Those who proclaim every morning, Ma koicheinu, ma gevuroseinu. Those of whom it's been said in the Piyutim on Yom Kippur, Me'utei ma'as. Nishuyei toiva. Seveye roiges, agume nefesh, those whose deeds are sparse, whose powers are paltry, whose lives are punctuated by countless frustrations, failings. It was heaven against earth. In the tug of war for the neshama. It wasn't a fair fight. And we lost. Nitzchu areilim es hametzukim. But why? Why did the battle start to begin with? I don't know. I'm not so smart that I know the cheshbonos lemala, nor am I so foolish to think otherwise. But if I had to guess, I would guess that the answer is someone a prior speaker mentioned tonight, things were happening in the Yeshiva Shel Milo, in the Masifta Derekiah. There was an opening for a Rebbe. They needed a Rebbe, but not Stam a Rebbe. A Le'elo, Le'elo Rebbe. A Rebbe who was not only a Magid Shir B'Chesed Elyon, not only someone who could challenge other people's minds, but who could pierce their hearts, who could quicken their souls. Not enough for this Rebbe to be respected. Not enough to be revered. This had to be a Rebbe who would be loved, passionately loved. So the Yeshiva Shel Milo sent their shluchim. And the Malachim came down to look for such a Rebbe. And they finished their mission and they returned upstairs. Mishut ha'aretz u'meyisalich ba. And they said, we found our man. They found their man and they fought for their man. And we lost our man. Toira, toira, chigrisak. And all we have is the memories. And the family has asked me to put those memories to words. To eulogize someone who was my brother in every way except biologically. Someone who, though many years my junior, was in so many ways my Rebbe. As he was to just about everyone here. And what they're asking me to do, zu avodah kasha shebamikdash. Chazal say that the Torah is tchilosa chesed v'soifa chesed. If I had to describe my parsha with Reb Dovid, it was a long parsha, 44 years, a parsha of one big zchus for me, one big joy for me. But I will tell you, it was tchilosa bechi, v'soifa bechi. The first time I met Reb Dovid Sharfman, 44 years ago, I didn't know him. I didn't know much about most members of his family. It was a summer, 44 years ago. I received a call at home in the middle of the night. It was a Motzoi Shabbos. It was summertime. I was home. I was not in yeshiva then. I was back home in my parents' house in Connecticut. And I got a call from a friend of the Sharfman family. Rebbetzin Hinda Sharfman was niftar on Shabbos. And the levaya would be the next morning. And so, of course, I came. I didn't know the Sharfman family, except for one, a young lady by the name of Bela Sharfman. I was dating her at the time. We weren't engaged. No decisions had been made. At least she hadn't made any decision. I was anxious as anything to put a ring on her finger, but it takes two to make that decision. No decision had been made. I was there. I made the trip to Brooklyn. And there for the first time I saw little Dovid, who wasn't so little. He was a giant in the making. But still, he was little Dovid. And at that Lavaya, I cried. I cried to my Shalish. Did I cry for the Nifteris? No, honestly, I didn't. I didn't know her. Did I cry for the young lady whom I was hoping to make my kala? I'll tell you honestly, I didn't cry that much for her either, because I knew she's very smart and very strong and supremely capable, and she'd make it. But I cried for Dovid, because my heart was broken in 1,000 pieces. Because what kept running through my head was, was it sein mit dem Kind? A Kind muss doch haben eine Mama. So I cried. And when I saw Dovid for the last time, I cried too, but you know why I cried. And now they put me on a stage and they make me cry again. How many tears can you extract from these aging eyes? Golda Meir, former Prime Minister of Israel, is reputed to have chastised some Israeli politician who she perceived to be putting on false airs of humility. Her words to him were, "Don't be so humble, you're not that great. It takes a great person to have genuine humility." If Dovid could whisper into my ear now, I haven't the slightest doubt that he would say to me, "Yecheskel, don't spend the evening jabbering about me. Give acknowledgement. Give recognition to those who were important in my life, those who helped me, those who davened for me, those who were with me through all the years up to the last crisis." And he would have meant it, because he was a giant in every way. And a real giant can have the real anivus that Arav spoke to you about a few minutes ago. Consistent with the dictum of Chazal in the Yerushalmi, that Ritzoinoi Zehu Kibudoi, I will do what I think Dovid want me to do. I will express my thanks, his thanks, to the hundreds, to the thousands who rallied to his defense, rallied to his Yeshua. You heard much of it mentioned tonight. My mind was spinning when I was finding out from my kids' iPhones, self-chveis. I'm not a much of a tech person. I'm an old fuddy-duddy. But in our house, when the children came together with us during the last days of the crisis, the phones, the dinging and the pinging and the this and the that, and it's a ton, people sending messages. It was incredible how many Blat Gemara were learned for the Schus and the Yeshua and the Refua. How many Mishnayos were chazered? How many Kapitlich Tilim were said? How many Tfilos were poured out? How many tears were shed? How many Hachlotas Toivos were taken? How many Kabbalos Belev were done? There's no measure, ein mispar. One young man sent a message. One of my kids showed me on her phone. He made a neder. He's giving up his smartphone. He's giving up his smartphone for the Yeshua and Refuan's chus of Rabbi Sharfman. Do you know what it means for a teenage boy to give up a smartphone? Rabbi Yisrael Salanter said that it's more difficult to change one bad midah than it is to learn the entire Shas. If that's the case, for a young man to give up his smartphone, he learned Yerushalmi and Bavli, the whole thing, several times over. Because that was a sacrifice. A difficult sacrifice. To all of you, to everyone, those who are here and those who are not here, your efforts were not in vain. The bottom line isn't what we wanted. But no tefillah that was uttered, no ma'asim tovim that were done, no kabbalas b'lev that were taken seriously, none of them were wasted. There are cheshbonos lemaila, and the cheshbonos lemaila are perfect, beyond perfect. And everything is recorded, and everything is tucked away for future use. And every one of you, and those near and dear to you, are gebenched for every moment you took to do for Dovid Sharfman. Needless to say, the family, wonderful beyond wonderful, siblings, parents, nieces, nephews, cousins, in-laws, the whole Mishpacha, Baruch Hashem, the Kamen family is large. The Sharfman family is large. And without exception, in particular his sisters, he was the apple of their eye from day one. What they wouldn't do for him, how they doted over him. Ein ish meis elo leishtoi. Chazal. Dovid was yet not a youngster when he married. I guess in the derech of Chafetz Chaim he waited his years and he looked carefully. And he chose carefully. In Mama Lashon we say, Lang gewart gut getan. And out gut getan. Did he ever hit the jackpot? Did he ever hit the jackpot? This was a young lady walked away from all the promises of marrying wealth, living a cushy life. She gave it all up to marry a budding young Talmud Chacham, who she knew the Parnassah would never be easy, and it would go into eventually the gullus that so many Talmud Chachamim go into. And life would not be a bed of roses. And that's what she chose. And she sacrificed for him. And she sacrificed with him. And with him, they built a home, L'shem u'l'siferes, L'ois u'l'degem, a home where chesed prevailed. A home which was the foundry where thousands of neshamas were shaped, created, purified, beautified. She tended to him. She tended to their children. She tended to countless members of the community. And in the final stage, as she kept their dark secret in her heart, she tended to his wounds, tended to his pain, ever graciously, ever gracefully, with unfailing bitachon. If last year or 5 years ago or 10 years ago, a young chassan would come to me and ask me, you know, we're going to have Sheva Bracha soon. What is the meaning of the bracha that starts, Sameach to Samach Reim Ho'ahuvim? What is Reim Ho'ahuvim? I would tell him, and this is not my chiddush, I would tell him that Chazal are describing here what a marriage, in its most perfect sense, consists of. Husband and wife are ahuvim, and they are reim. They are beloved of one another, and they are best friends of one another. The two don't necessarily coincide. They complement each other. And if this chassan would ask me, but what does that mean? How do I do it? I would have told him, get yourself over to North Miami Beach. You find out where a certain rabbi and Mrs. Dovid Sharfman live. And you watch them. You hang around. You watch them day in and day out. Hear their words. See how they interact. Observe the look in the eye. Notice the body language. And take notes. Copious notes. And after you've collated all of those notes, you will have the comprehensive guide on how to live married life as Reim and Ahuvim. Kisamechecho yitzircha began Eden mikedem. As the primeval Adam was, began Eden mikedem. You remember the Rashi. Zachor nekeva baroi som. What does Rashi say? Baroi shnei partzufim. The original Adam was a strange and beautiful amalgam of two people, the husband and the wife, in one. And that's what you saw in the Sharfman house. I'm not going to tell Mrs. Sharfman. I'm not going to give her pointless platitudes. I will leave it at saying, Hamokom yenachem oisach. Ushei maskurtech shleima. We are enjoined by Shleima HaMelech. Psach picho le'ilein. Speak for those whose lips are sealed. Rabbi David's lips are sealed. But I hear his voice telling me not to forget one other point. One other person who was entitled to a special thanks. A person who, when Dovid became a Yosem Minaim, took a special, I don't know, also a Kabbalah Belev. I don't know if she verbalized it in her own mind. But essentially what she said was, was a mame volt geton, velichton. My brother Dovid doesn't have a mother. But someone decided to bridge the gap, to fill the shoes to the extent that it can be done. And this is a woman. I can't even begin to tell you, and I'm not going to tell you, how she cared for him, how she extended herself for him. How she gave him her koyach, her mayach, time and treasure, from the time that he was a pitzela till he had his own pitzelach. The packages, the ma'adanei melech she made for him regularly, the packages of the nasharai, and not just for the children, for David himself. And this went on day in and day out, the comforting words, how she dried his tears, how she shared his happiness. And I could go on and on and on and on till half past Wednesday. You wouldn't know the half of it. But I saw it up close and personal, day in and day out, year in and year out, decade in and decade out. In case you don't know who this person is, I'll give you a hint. You remember that one I told you about upon whose finger I wanted to place a ring? That's the one. Except I will correct one thing that she verbalized incorrectly. Her last words to her brother, Ba'ol Mohadein, were Dovi, I don't think that there was ever a sister who loved her brother more than I loved you. And the thought was right, but the words were wrong. What she should have said was, Dovi, there was never a mother who loved her child more than I loved you. Chazal tell us that there were two Kedoshim called Pappus and Lulainus. You may know the Agadita. Chazal say, Ein birya oimedes bimchitzoson. They lived so nobly, they died so nobly, that their place in Gan Eden is beyond what anyone else can hope to reach. Gan Eden evidently has different sections. Like, you have coach, you have business class, you have first class. So there's the super duper first class in Gan Eden, and some special people are zeicha to that, and others just don't make it. They may be in Gan Eden, but they're not in the choicest real estate of Gan Eden. Pappus and Lulainus had their own section. If that's the case, I will conclude by telling you that my heart tells me that there's a special section in Gan Eden. We'll call it the section for those who didn't. When David was a pitzela, and his mother went basa'ara hashamayma, his memories of his childhood revolve substantially around seeing a mother in agony for years. This mother was a, can I say it, a tzaddikus. She was ever gracious never showed her inner pain. Her bitachon was unfailing, but she suffered, and Dovid knew it. These were his childhood memories. This woman was the light and the life of her family, her community. And Dovid, a little boy, barely a Ben Eser LaMishnah, saw that life ebbing away. And he saw the light extinguished. And he could have become a very bitter and angry boy. He could have. But he didn't. And as he moved on in life, in the teen years, he faced the same challenges, the same temptations as every boy does, and perhaps more so. He didn't have the loving heart and the guiding hand of a mother. He lived in the school of hard knocks, ve'ein kan mokum laharich. But it wasn't easy. We sometimes think of Gedolim as breezing through life, everything went well. It didn't go that easy. And he could have become a wayward, rebellious young man, but he didn't. And as he moved into young adulthood, he lived in the same world we do. The temptations are there. All the blandishments of the great wide world are there. And he could have, as some do, succumbed, but he didn't. Dovid was possessed of a brilliant mind. If I tell you brilliant, my wife, who's a mathematician, was tutoring him on a math course so he could take it for college credit. He didn't attend the course. She taught him an entire year's course in 2 days. He was a brilliant young man. He could have chosen easily a career, law, medicine, business, commerce, science, you name it. And he would have been so much the richer for it. We would have been the poorer for it. But he could have gone the way so many others did. With his mind, with his powers of perseverance, he would have been a runaway success in whatever he set his mind to. But he didn't. And when he chose the path, lilmoid ulalamed, to mold new Yidden, young, old, he didn't have to go south of the Mason-Dixon line. He could easily have stayed where he was, near family, near the yeshiva, in familiar environs, and had covered malachim, but he didn't. He went where he felt he was needed. In the end, when the Yisurei Iyov were upon him, he could have taken it easy. He didn't have to say every shir. He didn't have to attend yeshiva and minyan all the time. He didn't have to be the Superman. And I won't even tell you the stories what a Superman meant under those circumstances. He didn't have to. He could have chosen the easy way and say, Ichabshin ken koyachnit, it's over. Let me rest. But he didn't. For that little boy who didn't, and for that gentle giant who didn't, there's a special place in Gan Eden. My precious Dovi. The last time we conversed, you were non-ambulatory. You were in your wheelchair. And I said, Dovi, we will yet dance together, you'll see. And we will. When the day comes that Yeshaya's words are fulfilled, HaKitzu v'rananu shoich ne'yofar, Dovi and I will dance. We will dance with such gusto, with such fire, that those very malachim who snatched him from us are going to come down and watch and quell and applaud. But until that day comes, our nechama, or chatzi nechama, is knowing that Dovi is upstairs together with his holy forebears, those whose blood flowed in his veins, those whose masoiras he treasured and transmitted, those whose names he carries and to whom he brought such pride. The Mizritcher Magid, Rav Pinchas Koretzer, Rav Lev Yitzchok Barditchever, the Elter Zaydis, Rav Baruch David Weitzman, a Rebbetzin Weitzman, carries his name. A Rav and Rebbetzin who kept Yiddishkeit alive after the hammer and sickle had cast the deadly shadow over the Soviet Empire. Rav Arye Leib Sharfman, he carries his name too. Rav Arye Leib Sharfman and Mrs. Sharfman, who brought from Europe the Frumkeit and the Chassidus, which in the last century America were so scorned, mocked, ridiculed, and they carried it here and made it flourish here. And he's with them. And he's with his mother, the mother he hardly had a chance to know in this world. He's with her. Dovi, bring them all together, all the Kedoshim and the Tahorim. Bring them to the Kisei HaKavod. Summon up all your powers of advocacy and beg for us. Plead for us, because we so desperately need Yeshua's and the Chumais.
We're going to be hearing now from Rabbi Dovid Sharfman's father, Rav Nosson Dov Sharfman Shlita, who's we recorded this Erev Shabbos. Just that you know, Rabbi Sharfman Sr. is Talmud of Dovid. When I went to Menachem Avil, he was talking about the Levaya of Rav Dovid Leibowitz about 75 years ago, his drive back when they heard about Pearl Harbor. So he's quite a perspective, and thank you for the video team. It's a very short video to hear the words of Rabbi Sharpen's father.
I am completely distraught and in great sorrow by the loss of my beloved and cherished son, Rav Baruch Dovid Arye, Zecher Tzadik V'Kadosh Levracha. I was zocheh to bring him into the world as his father. He had two illustrious grandfathers, Rav Baruch Dovid Weitzman, an illustrious Rav in Brownsville, New York, and my father, Rabbi Sharfman, who learned in Slabodka Yeshiva in Europe. He was Baruch, he was blessed from birth. And when he was named Rav Baruch Dovid Arye, So we decided to call him Dovid, but he was Baruch, blessed, from the very beginning of his birth. We were blessed to have him as our beloved son. He was a lion in all his activities, active, participant, very much involved in everything with all his heart and soul. His revered mother, Alte Hilda, cherished him as the proverbial apple of her eye. His relationship with his, his relationship with his beloved, devoted, and selfless wife and partner, Shifra, was a model for others and an inspiration to all. His beloved children revered him. He was an adored brother to his beloved sisters and brothers-in-law. He was an inspiration to all. The Cayman family adored him. He, as I have said, he was an adored brother. He was born years after his sisters. They should live and be well, and they adored him. And he was, of course, very much beloved and close to them. The Cayman family, as I said, adored him, not only as their son-in-law, but as a son. He was an inspiration to his hundreds of Talmidim, who revered him as Rebbe and Mashgiach Ruchni of the renowned Chafetz Chaim Yeshiva of North Miami Beach. He fulfilled completely the teachings of what we learn in Pirkei Avos, the teachings of Shimon HaTzadik. And the Mishnah says, Shimon HaTzadik oyem ishyorei kinesis agdolo. He was of the great synagogue. Hu ayayimu, Shimon HaTzadik said, Al shlosha dvarim ha'olam omed. The world stands on three things. Al ha-Torah, v'al ha-Avoda, v'al gemilus chasadim. Dovi represented all these three in his love of Torah, in his love of mitzvos, in his love of teaching others. These hundreds of Talmidim, many people in Shiurim in the community. He was very, very delighted to be able to share his learning, to be able to share his knowledge, to be able to share his inspiration, to be able to share his feelings of love for Torah with others. As far as Avoda was concerned, he was Eved Hashem, not just as far as Tefillah is concerned, but he was an Eved Hashem. He served Hashem with his heart and soul and spirit all his years, and unfortunately he didn't have that many as we would had prayed and thought that he could have, unfortunately. But every year, every day, every month, was something that was useful and meaningful to him. He didn't just spend his life, he didn't just live a certain number of years, but he lived a life which was an inspiration, an example, a model to others of what Torah and Avoda should be. He could not live any other way. From the days that he was a little boy, sitting next to me in the shul, on the bima, shaking hands with people who had come by after they had received an aliyah, filled the years as he grew up and went to the yeshiva and learned, and he got smicha, yere, yere, yodin, yodin, from the mesifta and from the yeshiva Chofetz Chaim and from Rav Henoch, labor was zecher tzadik lebracha. It was always Torah v'yavoda. As far as Milos Chasanim is concerned, all those who knew him knew that Shifra and Duvi always had an open house. The boys of his yeshiva can always come there and find that they were welcome. It had an open house, not just for the boys of the yeshiva. He had an open house for everybody. He had a feeling that everybody was part of his family, his own beloved family, his own sisters and brothers-in-law, those that were, and his beloved wife, of course, but he felt that everybody shared with him in his family. And so he exemplified, and I just touched on the surface, he's exemplified the three basic principles upon which Shimon HaTzadik said the Torah stands: Torah, V'yavoda, and Gmilas Chasadim. There's much more. That I would want to say, but I know there are others who are going to say how they feel about his law, how they feel about Dovid. So I will simply conclude by saying that I love you, Dovid. I will always love you. I will always love you, my beloved son. And one son, Boaz Dovid Aryeh, blessed, a lion, a giant among men. As long as Hashem keeps me alive, I intend to keep him spiritually alive in the world as long as Hashem allows me. To Dovid, your name and your presence will always be part of us and part of me and of us. The Rabbeinu Shalom should bless the family in your schus, as you are always a guter better for everybody. In your schus, there should be simchas and achas, suras tovos. Your beloved Shifra should find comfort and consolation from the fact that she was privileged to have you as her husband, and you were privileged to have her as your wife. May you find consolation in the realization that there are so many who mourn, and so many who miss you, and so many who will always revere and cherish you. We should be zeichah in the future that there should be many simchas and nachas in the family, and your beloved Shifra should be able to still have simchas and nachas from her children and from grandchildren and from those to come in the future. We should be zeicha to see simchas for Klal Yisrael. We should be zeicha to see Yeshua's and Achamas for Klal Yisrael. We should be zeicha to the Bias Goyal Tzedek from Hera V'Yameinu. Amen V'Yameinu.
I would like to call on our last speakers, really Talmidim to a certain extent. So much of Rabbi Sharfman was presented to the community through the shiurim that he gave to the balabatim of our community here at the yeshiva. I would like to call up and thank Mr. Harvey Lichman, who helped orchestrate these shiurim and worked very hard with Rabbi Sharfman in presenting these to the community. Mr. Harvey Lichman.
Shusha Rosh Hashiva, Rabbeim, Rebbetzin Sharfman, family, and the friends that have come here. 9,248,500. Everyone knows that the yeshiva does an excellent job of educating children and young men. In 2008, the concept of creating a shir given to Bala Batim was broached. After deliberation as to when, how, and what, an attempt to try out this experimental shir was hatched. Rabbi Sharfman, being a Baki in Halacha, was handpicked to lead this experimental shir. Hence, Sunday morning's Rise and Learn shir was started as a 7-week experiment. The concept that on each Sunday morning a self-contained shir would be given on halacha. The first week's shir that Rabbi Sharfman chose to give was entitled From Charon to America, the Protocols of Shidduchim, and 20 men came. That was considered a pretty respectable amount. Until the second week came, when over 30 people showed up to a shir entitled Bungee Jumping and Cosmetic Surgery, the Halacha Comparatives to Avoid Sakana. The experiment was over and the shir was born. And as we went from shir to year to year, Rabbi Sharfman continued to come up with extremely unique, interesting, pertinent, and thought-provoking shirs on Halacha. Rabbi Sharfman was a Talmud Chacham, as we've all heard. He was an expert in halacha. He was incredibly organized. He was able to deliver his thoughts with clarity, with joy, with an occasional story, and at times when appropriate, a sense of humor. And all of this with extreme passion. And Rabbi Sharfman's unique style and knowledge attracted a wide range of Bala Batim that attended this year. They came from all different communities of South Florida. The participants were composed of those who had extensive yeshiva background, including people of smicha, to those who never attended yeshiva. From birth to balei tshuva. Yeshivish, right of center, left of center. Some were Ashkenaz, some were Sephardi. Some were involved in kashrus, some were lawyers, doctors, dentists, accountants, computer experts, businessmen, rabbeim, teachers, retirees, and others. There were those who would take copious notes during this year. There were those who followed the handouts, and there were those who just listened. There were those who participated in this year by asking questions, making comments, and every once in a while a funny line found its way in. There were those for whom this year was one of many that they attended during the day, and there were those for whom this year was the one and only year of the week that they attended. There were those who stepped into the yeshiva for the very first time, and there were those who, so to speak, lived in the yeshiva. And although you will never hear it from them, how proud do you think the kids in the yeshiva felt when they saw their fathers davening with them and attending a shir in the same yeshiva as them? What an example that sets. Yet, with that wide range of participants, Rabbi Sharfman could reach out and touch every single student. He reached their intellect, he touched their hearts. He connected with each person, regardless of the background. He taught to everyone's individual's level and at the same time to the entire shir at once. Everyone felt that the shir was geared to their level and that each person was just as important to the shir as the next. This truly reflects the incredible ability that Rabbi Sharfman had. And of course, in the Chafetz Chaim tradition, after the shir, a group would approach Rabbi Sharfman and ask him even more questions. And he had the patience to answer each and every one of them, no matter what level the question was asked on. Additionally, in my opinion, one of Rabbi Sharfman's more unique strengths was his humility. If a question came up and he did not know the answer, he quite simply said, "I don't know. There are not too many people around who can do that. How is it possible? How does one do that? I certainly don't know, but Rabbi Sharfman had this incredible ability and insight into people. Rabbi Sharfman's shiur changed the lives of all of us. One participant told me that until this shiur, he used to do gardening on Sunday mornings. Not anymore. There's another person here tonight that missed only a handful of shiurim during the entire program. There's another person who started coming because his wife saw the flyer and suggested to her husband, why don't you try the shiur? And he now rarely misses a shiur. During the summer, when Rabbi Sharfman was away on well-deserved vacation, many people came up to me and asked, when would the shiur resume? Because they were having withdrawal symptoms. And on those very rare occasions, it troubled Rabbi Sharfman tremendously when he had to cancel a shiur. Nobody really understood then the value of recording the shiurim. There were many people who could not attend the shiurim or lived out of town and downloaded them. During the period of Rabbi Sharfman's illness, men and women, young and old, came up to me and told me that they were downloading the shiurim and listening to them for a zechus. One member of the shiur during the period used one of Rabbi Sharfman's shiurim as a basis for his speech at his grandson's bris. Now all of those shiurim, his Torah, represent a part of Rabbi Sharfman's legacy that he has left for the family, the community, and all of Klal Yisrael. 9,240, 8,500. Rabbi Sharfman gave 240 shiurim over 9 years, representing approximately 8,500 hours of Torah to those who attended the shiur weekly in person. Not bad for an experiment. And with Rebbetzin Sharfman's bracha, the shiur will continue next week. Le'ul Nishmas Harav Baruch David Aryeh Hatzal ben Harav Nosson Dov Yibanel Chaim. We will all miss Rabbi Sharfman, but each of us will have our own personal memories, the impact he has made on us, the Torah we have learned from him, and the inspiration that he left us. Thank you, Rabbi Sharfman, my Rebbe.
Is a great kavod, all the alumni that flew in, and to the many alumni who wanted to come in, who just couldn't. So we'd like to ask one of the Talmidim, the alumni who flew in, a very close Talmid, Mr. Eitan Dreyfus.
Birshus Rosh Yeshiva, Choshev Rabbanim, family and friends. I feel truly humbled to be standing here tonight to give Kavod Acharon to a Rebbe who meant so much to us. Although I am the one standing up here, this speech is really a collection of thoughts and feelings that were presented to me over the past few days. When I mentioned to some of the guys that I was asked to speak, the stories that depict who Rebbe was came pouring in. While I will try to capture the essence of these anecdotes, I ask Mechila in advance if I don't get a chance to repeat a story or insightful comment that was sent to me. There is so much to say, but so little time. Most people know that I was very close with Rebbe. What they may not know is that over 15 years ago, when I came to Miami, I went straight to a Neumann shiur and was never in Rebbe's first year shiur. Still, we established a connection. This was the beauty that was Rebbe. I'm not sure if we bonded over the fact that we were both Brooklyn boys, went to the same elementary school, also called Yeshiva Torah Semes. But it was an instant warmth I felt from the initial hug I received upon arrival. Rebbe wasn't a handshake man. He was a really big hugger. That's who Rebbe was. I was extremely close with him, even without being an official Talmid in his shiur. The vast knowledge that Rebbe had of Torah, Shas, Medrash, Halacha, and Hashkafa was not shaykh. He was a brilliant man, yet he had the ability to break down a sugya piece by piece, no matter how difficult it was, and simplify it so everyone understood it. And if he wasn't sure a Talmud got it, Rebbe would go to that Talmud later that day to make sure he was on the same page as everyone else. Rebbe was so easy to talk to. Oftentimes you encounter a Rebbe that may be intimidating. I would say the only thing that was intimidating for me about Rebbe was his height. But Rebbe was such a gentle soul. He was charismatic and put you at ease during a conversation. He cared so much about his Talmidim, respected them, encouraged them, and always made them a top priority. He helped instill, even in his young Talmidim, a level of confidence, making each Talmud believe, I can be something, and I can do something important. Simply watching Rebbe in action led many of my chevra to follow in his footsteps and go into chinuch as well. They saw the example Rebbe set and wished to emulate him by becoming quality rebbeim and mashgichim themselves. This made Rebbe the quintessential mashgiach. The lines that used to be waiting to speak to him outside his office right here were the ones you would see when you visit a Rebbe. And he wore a tishbekesha, so he was our Rebbe. He taught us to do avodas hakodesh and mitzvos with our gusha and passion. And Rebbe taught by example. When Rebbe shmoozed or gave a shir, he gave it over with fire. When he sang zmiros on Shabbos, especially tov lehodos and yibane hamikdash lately, as per the Rebbetzin, he sang with complete passion and joy. He loved Shabbos, and it was obvious to everyone around him. He loved Eretz Yisrael passionately as well. A few years back, the yeshiva had summer's mon in Eretz Yisrael. I had spoken to Rebbe during the planning stages, and it seemed like he was more excited than the Bachrim to go. Another standout midah of Rebbe was his pure Simchas Achayim. His smile lit up the room, and his laugh was contagious. A person couldn't help but be in a better mood when around him. And when someone had a simcha, Rebbe enjoyed it as if it was his own. I had the zechus of Rebbe attending my wedding in New York. Having him there was a true enhancement to the simcha. He was so genuinely happy to be a part of it, so proud of me and my accomplishments, and he made my simcha even more exciting by simply showing how happy he was for me. And after reading the emails I received from others, it is obvious he made them, all of them, feel the same at their simchas as well. Baruch Hashem, I was able to keep in touch with Rebbe on a regular basis. But over the years, there have been longer periods of time when Rebbe and I were out of touch. Still, the minute we got on the phone, Rebbe picked up the conversation right where we left off, as if it were 5 minutes instead of 5 months that went by. Rebbe was so comfortable to talk to. He was approachable, non-judgmental, and there was nothing too trivial for Rebbe to listen to. His main concern was his Talmidim's welfare, and it showed in every conversation we had. It is no wonder that so many others kept in touch with Rebbe just the same. He had an incredible ability of being there for his Talmidim whenever we needed him, and even when we didn't know we needed him. He understood our individual needs, gave his complete attention to the person he was speaking to, and made each Talmud feel as if he was Rebbe's favorite. To quote from an email I received from a fellow Talmud, I truly feel I was one of his favorites, and at the same time, I'm not naive to think each and every other student over the last 20 years didn't think the same thing. End quote. With the strong connection we each built, no one was ever a former Talmud or a current Talmud. We were all his Talmidim. I've had many conversations with Rebbe over the years, but one particular message has always stuck with me. Rebbe said that when you start working and leave the full-day yeshiva life, first and foremost, remember you are a ben Torah. Yes, your mitzvah Hashem will build a family. Yes, you will have to provide for them. But always, always remember to make a Kiddush Hashem and keep being a mensch. It's not easy, but it's a lesson I hold dearly and hope to always live by. After hearing from so many guys, I think it is safe to say that we all love going to Rebbe's house. It wasn't just the wonderful and delicious spread that awaited us that was prepared by the Rebbetzin. It was also to see how a home should be. The Sholem Bayis and complete harmony between Rebbe and Rebbetzin Sharfman was simply inspiring. Watching them together and the way they brought up their children made me think, I want that. Rebbetzin, the relationship you and Rebbe had was a Moser lesson in itself. I would like to read an email that I received from another Talmud as it highlights this extremely special kesher. The email begins, one Motzei Shabbos, a couple of us went to Danny's Pizza in North Miami Beach, where we met Rabbi and Mrs. Sharfman. The next Motzei Shabbos, we met them there again. Right away, Rebbe comes over and starts apologizing to me. I promise, I'm not following you every week. It's just my wife is pregnant and asked if we can go out again this Motzei Shabbos. I assured him that I didn't suspect that he was looking to catch up the guys to no good at the only pizza shop in North Miami Beach, and we shared a good laugh. The real lesson, however, came about a half an hour later. My friend looks over at the Sharfman's table and says, do you see that? Look at them. They just look so happy to be just spending time with each other. I took a look, and I can tell you that never before or since have I ever seen an image like that of what was genuine happiness in Sholem Bayis. Two people who were just so happy to be spending time together, they sat there having a conversation, each one completely focused on the other, with smiles typically reserved for people that have won the lottery. With the aid of two slices of pizza, he gave us the greatest Musar lesson, walking the walk of being Mesameach Bechelko, demonstrating the only way one can be happy is by enjoying what you have. These are concepts we talk about all the time, but seeing Rabbi and Mrs. Sharfman on that date hit a message home like nothing else I've ever seen. That image is something I carry to this day. Whenever I hear couples getting into deep discussions about where they're going out to eat, I tell them about my mashgiach, who, unbeknownst to him, gave me the best lesson in Sholem Bayis I've ever received. The email ends. Rebbetzin, you are the support for Rebbe's every move. When he spoke about his Rebbetzin, it was always with such covet and admiration. You always had everything ready at home to host any number of Rebbe's Talmidim on a moment's notice, and always with a smile. You were his everything, and I know he was yours. We owe you as much gratitude as we do Rebbe, as he could not have been the incredible person he was without you by his side. When Rebbe talked about children, he'd always say how children should be brought up with a Havas Torah, Simchas Torah, with a Geschmack for learning, Feinkeit, and Ehrlichkeit. Looking at his children here tonight, Rebbe and Rebbetzin, you nailed it. Rebbetzin and family, Sheli Shalach V'Shalcha Shalach. Our successes are your successes. Our kids are your kids. Each step we take in the right direction is a step you take with us. And every family that has been built is because of you and Rebbe. Please know that with your support, everything Rebbe did, we are all the fruits of his labor. The amount of time and energy he put into us, everything we are today is because of Rebbe. He was so proud of his guys. So proud of our goals. So proud of our accomplishments. He was so proud to call us his Talmidim. But we are even more proud to have called him our Rebbe. May he be Melitz Yosher for the entire family, the yeshiva, North Miami Beach community, and Klal Yisrael.
I'm just debating, given the lateness of the hour, what I should read my prepared comments. I assure you, if it'd be the classroom, everybody would walk out. Rabbi Kamen says I should speak. Birshus kol ha-kol ha-kodesh hazeh. I became a classmate and friend of Rabbi Sharfman in 1974 when my parents switched my brother and I to Torah Semes Kamenetz. Being friends with Rabbi Sharfman at age 12, 11, quickly got me special treatment with the famed Menahel, Rabbi Elias Schwartz Zatzal, an icon in Chinuch. As Duvi, as he was fondly referred to, was a personal favorite of Rabbi Schwartz. Rabbi Duvi was brilliant, straight A student in everything, impeccable midos tovos. He always stood up for what was right from an early age. And his oldest sister married Rabbi Schwartz's son, who's here with us tonight. Rav Duvi was one of the brightest students throughout all the years of my schooling, Ad Hayom Hazeh. I asked him many of my halachic shailas. He took my many calls, as Chaim said, while shopping with his wife, wherever he was. He was brilliant with tremendous humility. He would always give me an answer, and then out of pure anivus would show me the Mishnah Berurah inside as if to say, unless I interpret it differently. He could paskin tefillah shailas practically in his sleep. He corrected the Baal Kori for dictic mistakes that changed the meaning of the word only. Haftorah, he corrected under his breath, only I could hear. I always joked with him that we've been talking to each other during davening for over 40 years. Shabbos Chol HaMoed, Pesach this year, is the first one after his Patira. We were all stumped. Do you say Adir Adirenu in Kedusha of Musaf on Shabbos Chol HaMoed or not? Only he knew. And he had notes in case anyone questioned in his file to prove it. He told me he could correct the Shliach Tzibur for getting Berachas Kohanim even in his mama's sleep from the time he was 12 years old. His father was the Rav Shul in Bensonhurst, and that was his job, catch Berachas Kohanim.
We were all planning to go to Yeshiva's Merkas HaTorah in Eretz Yisrael. Six of us, 12th graders and commandants. Fine, excellent yeshiva. One day, Rabbi Dovid changed his mind, and he told me he'd probably end up going to Chavetz Chaim, not Merkas HaTorah. Five of us, the other five who were supposed to go to Merkas HaTorah, switched and went with him to Chavetz Chaim. Rabbi Sharfman and I continued our learning in Chavetz Chaim in Queens, and we remained roommates for years until we got married. He was always the mashpia in our relationship, brilliant and humble. He was always mechabed me. When I became Rosh Yeshiva, when Rabbi Chait moved to New York, he would come to me anytime he had to miss 5 minutes of yeshiva to apologize if he had to miss some time. Even while he was so racked this year with skin issues, he told me once it took him over 90 minutes to get dressed in the morning. And yet he would apologize to me for coming a few minutes late. He had to miss Shacharis. And as much as I tried to tell him not to worry, he worried. As his roommate, as Bachrim, I watched him scour through Sfarim, especially Kitzah Shulchan Aruch and Piskei Mishneh Berurah. He became fluent in Dalet Chelkei Shulchan Aruch. At our Smicha Bechinas, he was so disappointed that the Bochein did not have time to ask us too many shailas on Hilchas Basa B'Chalav. I was so happy, he was so disappointed. He mastered anything he could look at. He told me about 10 years ago that he went through all of the shmuzim from Rabbi Yeruchim, Rabbi Chaim Shmulevitz, the Alter, and many other from the others from the previous generations. He gave a shiur in Aventura. I see Mr. Bonrin from that shiur. For four years, he gave the shiur every week on the Parsha. When I went to speak to some of the people, you could ask Mr. Marin, he wouldn't miss the shiur. His Sunday morning, Rise and Learn, was simply his fusion of the halacha and the Tanakh that he mastered coming together. The shiur gave him so much chias, he was enthralled to be able to give over the complex halachic queries to our community. In addition, for the last 14 years, he gave a shiur in Gemara to Balabatim Shabbos afternoon, very quietly in the back of the Young Israel, a shiur he inherited from Rabbi Grumblat when he was Rosh Yeshiva when he left. We asked him this year if he would take on another halacha class every morning, the 12th grade. I asked him, well, I was there when he was asked. He thought about it for less than 2 seconds and told me, I love teaching, for sure. Despite everything he was dealing with, he took this on. He loved Talmidim, and he was obsessed with teaching Torah. He never ran out of energy. The only thing that could stop was his patira itself. His shirim were on the highest level of sophistication and lumdus. His erudition and clarity were razor sharp. Listen to his many halacha shirim online. You can feel like you're the posek hador after hearing a shiur from him. Reb Chanina, at the end of his long life, the Medrash in Kohelet says that he was unsure in what schus he merited to live so long. Was it because he had deferred the nesius many years earlier to others he deemed more fit and roi? Or because one time he detoured on one of his trips to visit Reb Shimon Bar Chalafta? Moriva Rebbe Zatzal, the Rosh Yeshiva, Rabbi Henoch Leibowitz pointed out that giving up such a prestigious position takes untold humility. So much so that the great Rebbe said he would not have been able to do it himself. How does such a heroic, selfless act rate with a mere detour one time to give shalom to Rabbi Shimon Bar Chalafta? The Rosh Yeshiva answered that Rabbi Chanina was commenting on the taras halev, the passion the eslavas in which he performed those mitzvahs. And in his lifetime, he was able to find two events that stood out with the same taras halev, the same purity of heart. Rabbi Sharfman had such eslavas for so many things. His family, his rebbetzin, his sons and daughters, his sons-in-law and daughter-in-law, his grandchildren should take pride and nachas as to the schusim his taras halev brought to Klal Yisrael. One can point to the eslavas of his shiurim, his shmuzim and vadim. It was an inside joke in the Beis Medrash in high school. Rabbi Sharfman speaking today, maybe he'll get onto a rant about society and literally change everyone's life with one shmuz. But it did not stop at shiurim. Rebbeim and yeshiva put in many long hours. Many of them do. I was once finishing a 13 or 14 hour day here at yeshiva. I walked outside right here into the parking lot. A bocher came over to me and asked me, could you take me to the airport? I was exhausted. I told him it would be hard, but if you really can't find a ride, call me and I'll take you. Not hearing anything further, I just presumed he found a ride or he called a cab. The next morning, I see Rabbi Sharfman. How are you doing? He says, I have to go prepare. I couldn't prepare last night. What happened? He says, I had an airport run. I was afraid to ask him. Yes, that boy called Rabbi Sharfman, and Rabbi Sharfman said, of course, I'll be right over. He left and drove him to the airport. He used to dash to Publix after the 10:30 marv, often getting some nash for the barkham, as has been mentioned, for whatever reason was needed. He told the Rebbeim at an Hullah meeting earlier this year, when we were talking about the type of kesher a Rebbe should have with a Talmud. He told me the level of a kesher a Rebbe must have with a Talmud is one which the Talmud will feel comfortable when coming to his house and will go to the refrigerator without feeling the need to ask permission first. With what schus will we mark his matseva? It is impossible to pinpoint which area this great mashkiach was great in. To his heartbroken talmidim, both current and former, there was no greater kavod to your Rebbe than to continue the passion and eslavas in the areas that were so important to him. He felt that every single bachur in yeshiva can and must become a gadol b'torah. He let you know if you were goofing off with tremendous pain and love at the same time. I remember hearing him so many times, there is no tosfis that feels good when you go to sleep at 2 a.m. To his children, we know that he treated his talmidim like children also, and know that we will forever be makir tov to him and to all of you for allowing him to literally give his lev and nefesh to all of his children. To his rebbetzin, we will never fully know the mesirish nefesh that you both had. The many cakes and Purim sodas was just the tip of the iceberg that you prepared for the Talmidim. Were a demonstration of the caliber of Taras Alev that Reb Chanina was referring to. Let's all embark together on ways to memorialize Rabbi Sharfman, Rabbi Dovid Zatzal, by implementing the Ashkafas that he embodied, but more importantly, to emulate the passion and Islavas that helped transform our yeshiva and our community. Thank you all very much for coming. Yehi Zichro Baruch. Good night. Marv will follow.
El Molei Rachamim Shochein Bamromim Hamtzei Menucha Nechona Al Kanfei HaShechina B'malos Kedoshim U'tahorim Kedor HaRakia Mazhirim Es Nishmas HaRav Baruch Dovid Aryeh Ben HaRav Nosson Dov Shaholach l'olamo, bavur shanachnu nodvim bli neder tzedaka, bad haskoras nishmaso, began eden tehei menuchoso, l'chein bal harachamim yastirehu, b'seisir kanofov li'olamim, v'yitzar b'srachayim es nishmaso, Adonai hu nachaloso, v'yanuach b'shalom ha'mishkavo, v'nomar amein.